Welcome, everyone. This is Pine Leaf Noodles, and you're listening to LOTRO Players News, where we take a look at the latest news in LOTRO and here at LOTRO Players. And this week we have with us Andane.
Hey, everybody.
Terry Edwin.
Hi.
Maven.
Hey, y'all.
Erithert.
Hello, everybody.
Carvet.
At your service and your families.
And returning after being away for a while, Lily Kate.
Hello, everybody. It's good to be back.
Yay. Good to hear your voice.
I know. Let's hope it stays constant. It's good that you can hear me.
That is awesome. Fantastic.
Let's not jinx it.
Yes.
You do have a point with that. So therefore, let us head into... Oh, there is no game news. Well, then let's head into the store of sales.
Yeah, on sale this week. Well, this week's free sample is a Max Morell and Polyrush Scroll times one. Use coupon code MXMORPOW. Max Morell power. Okay. 25% off some travel stuff. Milestone skills, hurried returning and expedient traveler, riding traits, and simple rally horn. If you've been saving up for the journeyman riding trait that's across your account, now's the time to get it, which is super recommended if you have more than like two characters.
Now, what is the hurried returning and expedient traveler? Is that the cooldowns on the
milestones? Yeah, it's the reduced cooldowns on milestones and return skills.
They all stack too, don't they?
Yeah, they sort of stack with each other.
You can get it down to 5 minutes cooldown total.
Yeah.
Which is awesome.
Oh my god.
Which is what I have, and boy, does it make a difference.
Five minutes on your return to home skills?
Yeah.
Yep. Whoa, that's almost huntry.
It's worth getting.
It is almost huntry.
It's almost like what a class can do already.
It's completely worth it.
Yeah, but now you no longer have to yell taxi anymore, so, you know.
Right.
Every 5 minutes. I can't possibly wait 5 minutes for a ride. Well, you might be in war chat.
You might be a hunter if.
Mm-hmm.
Let's head into the community events for May 27th through June 2nd. And what is up in the community this week? Any highlights?
I've got one. I would like to recommend Instant Play, who play on Guaihir on Mondays at 2 p.m. That's server time. Some excellent arrangements from these guys.
Awesome. Cool.
Okay. Anything else?
There's definitely so much going on. It's just worth recommending everybody go and check out that post themselves. Takes a while to scroll through everything.
All right, then. Then let's have a little check-in with an event for next week. Something about a song contest at the Blue Theater.
Yes, I'm swimming in song contest. There was two posts. One is redundant now because it was a last call for people to enter, because we've already drawn the band order in which everybody's going to perform. And the other post, which was voting guidelines, is a general it's a general guide as to what to look for if you're going to vote, because I'm going to have a public poll as well as each of the bands. There's separate awards. There's a public award and there's a band award that's the actual contest award. And each band gets one vote and you're actually voting for the best arrangement in your opinion. So there's different guidelines as to what constitutes an opinion, if that's clear as mud, probably. So you know, you might want to vote for something that makes you feel the most, or you might want to vote for something that's technically difficult to do. All are valid and welcome, so come along on Saturday the 4th, 2 p.m server time in the Blue Theater in Minas Tirith, and fingers crossed everybody can get connected and stay connected and we can have a song competition.
And for those who don't know, the Blue Theater is on the fourth tier of Minas Tirith, on the far western
Plains
end.
Plains tier, yeah. It's all the way left if you're looking at the city from the gate. So players tier, go left, keep going to the end.
So let's then go into Weatherstock, announcing Weatherstock 8. Band registration is now open.
Oh, the kind people at LMB have released their date for Weatherstock this year. It's going to be the 23rd of July.
23rd of July.
Yep. Band registration is open, but just so that everybody knows, it closes Monday. So they need to get in and put in their application pretty quickly.
That's a pretty short window.
Also, there's slightly different rules to last year. So the Weatherstock Concert Series is only open to competing bands this year. So they don't have so much work to do last year because it was a bit of an ordeal for some of the staff. Competing bands only for the Weatherstock Concert Series, which is like the run-up one-hour concerts for each band to display the best arrangements, really. And I shall be hopefully reporting on as many as I can get to for Lecture Players.
Awesome.
All right. Then let's head into our poll where we ask the question, how much total gold do you have in Lotro?
That's right, Pineleaf, and a lot of people didn't actually want to count how much gold they had, and so people asked for a I have no idea option or something like
that.
Love
me. I have no clue. I use Titan Bar, which tells me how much gold I have across all the characters on the server. However, I play on like 6 different servers.
True.
I'm not adding all that up.
I just decided to go with the one that had the most, and since it was on the low end of one of the bands, I figure the rest of them aren't going to combine enough to go into the next band, so that's the one I'll take.
All right, and speaking of the different bands, the top answer, there were, first of all, 305 voters in this total poll. The top answer, with 27%, 82 votes, was 1,000 to 4,999 gold. That's a ton.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Spend it too fast.
Right. Next up, with 3 less votes at 26%, 100 to 499, followed by 19%, 57 votes of 0 to 100, and then 599 comes next with 17%, 10,000 plus at 6%, 19 votes, and then followed by 5,000 to 9,999 with 6%, 17 votes. So
I
that means
friends with any of those people.
That means that approximately 75% of the population in this poll has more gold than I do.
Yeah, there's a couple of people I know of on Gladden that have well over 100,000 gold, and they when they got to a certain point, they would just for the fun of it buy sections of like buy entire sections of the auction house, mark them up, and sell them off again. And I was like. Okay.
Meanies.
That's a terrible idea. No, what they should do is they should buy entire sections of the auction house
and lower everything.
Yeah.
That's not how they got to the 100,000, though, is what I'm saying.
I don't think
so,
Sarissa would do that, Terry.
I'm just telling you how they got there.
Sarissa doesn't play with the auction house.
Yet, until she finds out how lucrative it is.
Yeah, right.
Sarissa strikes me as more of a snatch and grab than a buy and sell.
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, she's not.
She's a blue collar burglar, not a white collar burglar.
Right.
All right, let's head into Lotro Academy episode 126, Crafting Part 2. And during that episode, we were joined by Maven, who helped us along to explain exactly what crafting is.
You couldn't have done it without me.
Yeah.
So is Crafting Part 2 where you go back to the system and then decide that you really don't like it and then go back to not using it?
I did that in Part 1.
Fair enough.
No, we just went into the details because I think part two was just talking about the vocations in general.
Yeah, we did. We took the whole time in part one just talking about what the vocations were. We didn't actually talk about like how you do it or any of that other stuff.
Right. So that's what we did in part two.
Yeah.
Did you guys go over the whole how to have one of every class or every crafting profession in as few characters as possible?
We talked about
five.
That.
Yeah.
It's like five characters, right?
Yeah, you can do four. It five.
I think you can get four, actually.
You can't. I mean, you can't have everything.
You
gilded,
can't
gild
obviously. Them. Yeah, you have to have seven to have them gilded, but you can do it in four, I think.
Wow, you guys are really
crafting.
Impressive. I know.
Well, when you start playing the game, as I did, as a free to player, and you were trying to maximize your TP versus your crafting,
yeah.
You start doing mathematical analysis and permutations, and you're like, well, if I make this for this guy and I pick that profession, I actually drew charts. I'm a nerd. I admit it. I have spreadsheets that I have from back in the day that show what crafter, what tier. What material they're making for who else. You do these kind of things and you go, oh yeah, I can totally do this in four characters. I got this.
Yep, I did that once upon a time and then I decided I really didn't like crafting that much.
That was a bit overkill.
I just picked what sounded good, so, you know. Duh.
Yeah, that's pretty much
it. Yeah, I think this time
part of the fun of crafting is coming up with a suitable backstory as to why that particular class would be crafting the way they are. Like,
in case you ever get asked.
No, I mean, it's part
like
of
my guardian.
Like, it makes sense for a guardian to be an armor smith, so they make their own weapons and shields. Armor and shields.
Yeah, like my roleplay character is metalsmith. He starts off as a metalsmith before he's a guardian, actually.
Yeah, but like, I had a champion at one point who started off as my scholar, and he was, you know, studying about different things, and he went out to the world and began learning about stuff, and the more he learned, the more he realized, I can make better weapons. And so I actually changed him from scholar to weaponsmith over time, but I had a backstory as to why I did that, because frankly, I wanted to make my lore master my scholar, because it made more sense. Anyway, yeah, so.
So which is the most mismatched, then?
Mismatched?
Yeah, class and craft. With race.
That would be interesting because you can really make a good story for any of them. I can't think of anything that would be like absolute like what, why?
See, I think everything fits.
If you were to take like a runekeeper and make him a metalsmith.
Yeah, that wouldn't make a lot of sense.
That one doesn't make a whole lot of sense because you couldn't make your own gear. You would have to like basically take everything you have and trade it with other people. Or a Bjorning and a metalsmith would be another one, because you couldn't make anything you could use.
But with the runekeeper, you could make lightning rods. It'd be great.
I used to pretend that my runekeeper that had scale armor would like channel lightning down his metal scales
and amplified
his power. Old school references. Anyway, that wasn't crafting. That
you
was
really
just...
do roleplay, don't you, Carve?
I'm getting more involved than I used to.
Apparently so.
I had backstory in my head, and I have an active imagination, but as I've been doing more streaming and more intricacies into roleplay, I'm like, you know what? I could totally do that. That would be fun. But I'm taking us way off course, so we did the crafting thing. We should move on.
Let's head into Tales of the Free Folk, episode 17.
Beware the Falconer!
For real.
Yeah, and the Falconer is one tough lady.
At least we think she's the Falconer. We don't know.
Yeah, we don't know.
Because, like, if she's a tough lady, then that's really weird. Because in Lotro, before the Northdowns revamp, the Falconer was a fat dwarf with a couple of elite guards who beat my champion repeatedly until I came back 10 levels over and kicked his face in.
Well, see,
that's the story of my
these
characters.
Are the... These Falconer, see, these Falconers, this Falconer, the one that we're going against, is the one who taught all of the wretched Falconers we face in skirmishes.
Oh, I get it.
Don't scare me, Pineleaf.
So does that mean we're going to have to sit there and listen to...
No.
For the next, like, four sessions?
No, there'll be even more, like, amazing whistles. Like, there'll be different types because they're, like, this awesome Falconer whistler. The one that taunts, yeah.
And then this huge obelisk drops into the middle of the room. Ba-ba! No. All
right. Let's head to Small Lotro Adventures, episode 55.
That was a long one.
The long one is right. he had the draw in there.
We had the draw, we had Ask Us Anything in there, and we had Bingo Boffin, and towards the end, Lizzie reads a couple of riddles in Italian, if anybody enjoys the riddles.
Yeah, that's right. How do I understand that riddle?
Well, we do translate them somewhat.
True.
The second one threw us a little bit. Because, of course, translating Italian to English doesn't actually work literally because of the grammar rules, which I'm totally rubbish at. So, you know, she has the wrong parent if she wants to translate anything over. So she riddles away in fluent Italian, which is, I'm quite impressed actually, because she's always been too shy to speak Italian before. And then Holly sends a couple of questions in live, and then we finish up on a game of Snap. She says, I scared her out of her soul.
Now, I was wondering, if you had those decks of cards there, why did you do the draw using dice instead of the cards?
No, she came in midway through with two decks of cards.
Oh, I thought she started with one and then got a second.
She let me do Bingo Boffin by myself. She wandered off because she wanted to go and ask her papa something. forgot whatever that was, came back with two decks card Snap, and then decided that we was going to play Snap whilst I'm still reading Bingo Boffin.
She's going,
this guy's boring, can we get on with it? Can we do something else? And I'm going, in a minute, Lizzie, I'm still reading it. It's a good story. She's like, no, it's not.
So is Willem the pine leaf of this story, where once pine leaf's gone, it's just, it's not interesting anymore?
She's not interested anymore if there's no links in there. She doesn't mind Tanglemane. Tanglemane's her backup pet. But, you know, what we was talking about, which was our favorite episode of Bingo, and she went straight to Willem. And then I mentioned the swimming. So she said, yeah, the swimming was good. So if they do, you know, pick up the action a little bit, then she might get back into it. But when there's long text, like that guy was just moaning about everything, she just turned her right off.
oh yes, Theodore is a bit tiresome.
See, I had fun with that because I do crazy voices with it.
Really? So. I know, I've not let her listen to it yet. She kind of likes to follow up on yours because your voices are better than mine. Yeah, but I'm like, in my brain's going, red stone. Eggwolf's looking for the last red stone. Hasn't somebody connected this yet? It's obviously that one. So yeah, we're still enjoying Bingo. She's just sad because we left Willem. And it's just tormented her ever since.
Then let's head into the family line. Part 93, Waiting for Kronog.
I actually read this just before we came on. It's very detailed. It's my first one. I'd not read one before. Like, you guys keep saying week after week, read it, it's good, read it, it's good. And I'm like, oh, I'll get to it next week. Or I'll wait till I've got a spare minute. And I never have a spare minute because there's too many interruptions.
Howdy, but you read part 93 without reading the 92 that came before it?
Yeah, because I thought it's going to be shameful of me if I come on the show and I've not read it.
That's awesome.
We're laughing because most of us don't get a chance to read it. And so now you're instantly more prepared than all of us who theoretically do this.
Exactly, yeah.
Yes. I did enjoy it. It's very detailed. It's very descriptive. When Lizzie's grown up, I will come and read it from the start and sit down with a cup of tea, put my feet up, and just enjoy the lot. But a very good style of writing.
Then it might be over with, and Tim will have a PDF of like the whole thing.
Oh, that would be great.
Then that's really what I'm banking on.
Feet up properly.
Then let's head into Critters Journey 25. Herobrine, police.
Yeah. I actually haven't read this yet.
I did.
Well, of course you did.
I normally read Critters when I'm doing the show notes, but I was distracted this afternoon and didn't get a chance to go back and read it.
Well, if you like Ginger Kitties, this is the Critters Journey for you. I really like this one.
Awesome.
I love Critters.
Double thumbs up from me for Critters Journey this week.
Right. Then let's head into the latest installment of Piney's Pictorial Premiere to Skirmishing Protectors of Thangulhad.
This is your favorite skirmish, isn't it, Pineleaf?
Yeah, it is. So, having a chance to use siege equipment against orcs. Whap, whap, whap.
So I'm guessing like half of it is dedicated to just the siege equipment stats that you've made. Like if you angle perfectly and wait for this exact second, then using the Pineleaf Countdown app, then you of course are able to hit the enemy exactly right on spots.
Now here's the question. Do you hit the first few, or do you wait for those to go out of the circle and grab the middle bunch?
That depends on my mood at the time. I'm more likely to go after the first one because it'll slow them down a little bit, and therefore everybody will arrive together, and I could use my AoE snuff. If I were using it on a squishier class, it might be better to go on the latter ones because the first few would arrive quickly. You could kill them while the others who have been slowed down by your hit will come later. So it might be better if you're squishier to do it in the opposite way.
But see, I'm not coordinated enough for that. I just kind of sling it when they get in the general vicinity and hope I hit some.
Just remember, it's better to fire early than late because if they get all the way through at it, then anything you shoot isn't going to hit them. But it lingers, the fire, that's because the ballista has this fire pots in it, I guess, and so it's continually burning after a little while. So anyone that comes through for a few moments will also be hit by it.
And you can learn these tips and more by reading the Pineleaf Pictorial Primer to Skirmishing Protectors of Thangulhad.
It's kind of like a siege engine with I forget what the name of the skill is.
Well, I always think there's nothing more satisfying than getting the lieutenant and getting him down to a third of his morale with one of those catapults.
Like
when you do a little dance in your seat, yes!
What's really fun is if you can hit a wretched falconer perfectly with the ballista, and he's already down, so that the shield is, because if it, the ballista goes through the shield.
Nice.
Ah.
So therefore, if you can get his shield, I think if I hit a wretched falconer in duo, I think after one or two birds, he's at the point where the shield disappears. So it's like, sweet.
That's the only way to deal with a wretched falcon. Yeah, with a ballista that's loaded with sticky wards.
Yeah, I don't care. Right, I don't care if that wretched falconer is the only one that gets hit and I miss everybody else as a result of it. I'm going after that falconer.
So now next week there's going to be all these people doing Protectors of Thangulhad, and Turbine's going to be wondering, why is this happening? And then Pineleaf will just say, of course, it's the falconer tip that I just gave. Now everyone can kill the falconer without having to worry about it.
I spent about a week doing Thangulhad when I was getting my Skirmisher Middle Earth title, and I've had enough of that skirmish forever.
Well, yeah, especially in trying to get that warg.
The last one that you're waiting for, whoever it is, and it never pops up. That's so frustrating.
It doesn't matter which one it is, whichever one is the last one, and it just seems like it takes half past forever for that
5 days. And I was doing Thangulhad solidly for 5 days.
Oh, good grief.
I know, but I was determined to get my title so I could check it off my list.
All right. Then it is time for us to head into the main part of today's episode. So I hand over the show to Andang as we enter into our Update 18 review.
Yes, thank you, Pineleaf. It is once again that time to be reviewing another part of LOTRO. This time we are going to be reviewing Pelennor Fields, or Update 18, whichever one you want to call it. We will be reviewing the entire update as a whole. And I'm going to go ahead and give a spoiler alert, of course, and hand it over back to Pineleaf, who so expertly goes over the epic story. So, major spoiler alert for the epic story with Update 18 and Pelennor Fields and all that stuff. Go ahead and skip ahead about 20 minutes. Pineleaf has told me that it's going to take about 15 minutes for him to go through everything, and then another probably 5 minutes of discussion that we'll have. So go ahead and go forward 20 minutes, and we will. That way you won't get anything spoiled. And if you're listening live, just mute for 20 minutes, or you know, maybe stop listening to the episode, because it's mostly going to be review this week. So if you don't want it spoiled, then there's not much show left. So. And you can always come back and listen to the show on the podcast after the fact. So without further ado, Pineleaf, what went on in the epic story in Update 18?
If you remember from Update 17, at the end, we had a little vision from Denethor where we saw what would happen to Minas Tirith if the Riders of Rohan did not arrive. Mithrandir thus sends out onto the quest a find out what happened to the messenger with the red arrow, and to make sure that the riders do arrive on time. Thus, we are sent down for the first tier, where we are to go and check, get a good fast horse, so we can ride out right away. And of course, we find out that there's a problem in the stables. That is because some nasty person's been spreading rumors that Gothmog, one of the leaders of the Morgul host, cannot be killed as long as some ranger called Goladir is still alive. Thus, everybody is now in despair, and we find out that the source of these rumors are from a certain pair of brothers from the Blackroot Vale. We really should go and smack them. And after we do that, we then take our swift horse and head out and find out that, yes, indeed, the messenger with the red arrow is dead, but he's already delivered his message. So the Rohirrim are arriving, except that there is a host of orcs right at the exit to the forest. And obviously, cavalry have a lot of trouble getting out of a forest that's blocked by a host, because they're better in the open than out in the forest. So therefore, we are sent in to warn the Rohirrim about this way and see if there's another way they can get through the forest. And as we're searching through there, we find some mysterious footprints that eventually lead us to the village of the Woses, the wild men of the forest. And there we find out that the Woses are enemies of the orcs. Not necessarily friends of the Rohirrim, but this seems like a case where the enemy of my enemy is my friend could work out very well.
At least until Theoden gets enough rep to, of course, be friends with the Woses.
Right. So therefore, we then go and make a deal with them where the leader of the Woses, Khan, or is there a better way of pronouncing that?
Gun.
That sounded great, Pineleaf.
Right. He says that if we help him to recover the body of his son, who was killed by the orcs in one of their camps, then he will help us. So therefore, we join his younger son, and we go to the place of the orcs, where we distract the orcs by fighting them, of course, while the son goes around shooting poisonous darts at the orcs and killing them. After that's being done for a while, he recovers the body, we return, and then we join Khan too. I'm sorry, I can't get that consistently.
It's gonna hurt after a bit.
Yeah.
You might want to just use a G sound instead to save your voice, finally.
Yeah, I'd say, you know, you don't need to be super...
We go to the Rohirrim camp, and yes, we find the Riders of the Mark, who are all resting before they make their final push towards Minas Tirith. And there we get to meet all the various Thanes so that we can get to know them again. be friends with them again, bond with them again before they go into battle and get themselves killed.
Pretty much.
Just in case you forgot who any of those guys were.
Right. So therefore, we go in there and do that, and after which we are sent and we meet Horn. And Horn, we find out why he's there and that he has, of course, departed from Nonan for a while and says that he wants to go and save and make the world safe for Nona and the child that he now knows is coming.
Dun, dun, dun.
I know, what a shock. Once he is doing that and Horn has had that discussion, we then talk to Galeowina, and then afterwards we speak with Mary, who somehow hitched a ride with the Rohirrim, and his friend who's helping him along, a very silent writer by the name of Durnhelm. And once we meet all of them, we go to Theoden, and we learn that Khan, very Khan, has spoken with them, and they have, and that he will lead them by a route that has been forgotten for some while. It is a bit rocky, but don't worry, we've got Pine Leaf here to pick up all the rocks and put them aside so that everything is to go through.
Once the really, really small rocks.
Yes. Then once they all go walking down through all the way, we then meet with Éomer, who then asked us to mount up so we could head in to the charge for the ride of the Rohirrim, and we enter the battlefield in one of the most epic points in the entire storyline. That ends book 5.
When you play it, make sure you turn up your sound, because it's awesome.
Yeah,
if you don't have significant amounts of time when Éomer says to mount up your horse, don't talk to him or take the quest at that point.
Yeah, that might be a good idea.
Wait. Don't let your friend...
Oh, come on!
...talk you into just one more quest.
Oh, come on!
Okay, yes. There is that little detail.
You weren't in on it last night. I talked him into doing that to end his thing, and then he won't let me forget. But I thought it was a good way to end it.
Now, the third time I did this, I finally decided, all right, I've got to... Because I normally play without music because of the way I do my... Because I do a lot of recording, and so therefore I normally turn off my music. So the third time, I finally got around to turning on the music so I could have the music on during that particular point in it. Because, of course, you also got the epic music working in the background in addition to everything. Yes.
Epic music is epic.
Right. Yeah. And that's book 5. So let's go into book 6, The Battle of the Pelennor Fields. And we begin this battle by killing orcs and bonding with some of the other soldiers that are in the area. And once we finish doing this, we then head out in order to join in the battle and up towards where the king is when the Lord of the Nazgul descends upon the field, scaring Snowmane, Theoden's horse, which throws him off the horse and injures him fatally. Now, of course, the Lord of the Nazgul wishes his fell beast to feed upon Theoden, but one soldier prevents him and stands in the way. Durnhelm stands forward and says that the Witch King shall not approach and have him. To which the Witch King says, "No man may hinder me." To which Durnhelm replies...
Pilot makes a pretty good Nazgul.
Yeah. To which Durnhelm replies...
I am no man.
Yes, I am no man, or... Yes.
Dang, or, son, I ain't no man.
Right. To which...
Be gone, foul Dwemerlake! Sorry.
Right. To which Durnhelm removes her helmet and reveals that she is, of course, Eowyn. And at which time, she then, in an epic moment, chops off the head of the fell beast that is on the that the Nazgul is riding. The Nazgul, of course, the Witch King, not liking what she just did, takes out this mace that's about that seems to be about a ton in weight, because it's a really big mace here, swings it at Eowyn's shield, of course, breaks the shield, knocks her down, and is ready to kill Eowyn. And so Merry, then, who is riding with Eowyn, jumps back and stabs the Nazgul in the knee. Nazgul cries in pain. Eowyn kills Nazgul, and Eowyn falls to the ground. Nazgul disappears, and everybody is melancholy. Éomer comes, sees, of course, now his uncle is dying, and of course, Éomer becomes the new king, and then he notices Eowyn, and he says, cries out in rage, and goes out and wishes to kill as many orcs as he can. Whew. As a result of this, now people are in despair. The king of the Mark is dead. Their king is dead, and
long live the king.
Yeah, long live the king. But the king's not going to live very long if he's going around riding like a madman. So they're not exactly in the most high spirits at the moment. So we have to go in trying to get people's spirits back up so they could resume in the battle and hopefully not give in to despair.
I just imagine what we're telling them is, maybe not death. Doesn't have to be, you know?
You could go all Wraith, you know. Doesn't have to die.
Right. So therefore, we then join in with Ingbert, if you remember Ingbert, that is Horn's father. And we then go in and fight across the Pelennor Fields in order to try to meet up with Éomer. And in doing so, we run into our fun little brothers from the Blackroot Vale, who say, oh, don't worry, we can get you through these Orlephants without any trouble. They think they are the greatest experts in killing Orlephants. Well, of course, they do manage to distract the Orlephants while getting themselves killed. But that does clear the path for us, so we are able to continue along our way until we meet the next boss, a Wraith. Now, this Wraith is, you know how we've been meeting two main types of Wraiths. We had the Red Robed Wraiths, which are the Khargoul, and we had the Black Robed Wraiths, who are the Nazgul. Well, this is a dark gray Wraith, sort of a Nazgul wannabe.
I hadn't noticed that. That's a good point, Pineleaf.
So this Nazgul announces that, don't worry, the king returns to Minas Ithil at long last. Yes, here's the return of the king. Welcome your new king who's about to arrive. He, of course, he is talking about Gothmog here. And eventually, Imrahil pretty much says, let's face it, a Wraith with a crown is not a king, no matter what. So we then fight this Wraith and kill that Wraith, and eventually are able to get back to where Éomer is. All right, whew, good. We get back to Éomer, and Éomer, we're trying to cheer him up, we're trying to get him, and then he sees down in the distance at Harlond, they're coming of the black sails. The black ships are coming from Pelagir. Now, we know that Aragorn was on those ships when it left Pelagir, but we're not 100% sure that nothing's happened to him on the way here. So we think it's Aragorn, but we're not 100% sure. So we decided that while we think about what we're going to do, we'll go around, kill some orcs, and then we get back. Oh, this is when Éomer finally sees that it is now showing the Banner of Gondor, and it is indeed Aragorn arriving, and then the battle renews in vigor, and the battle rages all over the place. And then, this is where we have the meeting of the Rangers and the Gondorians. And one of the Gondorians was fighting side by side with Goladier. And when he hears Goladier's name, he, of course, hears that name everyone's recognizing, because everybody's been saying that this is the person who's keeping the Gothmog alive, and they have twisted it to believe that Goladier was in league with Gothmog, which is, of course, nothing could be further from the truth in the entire thing. And this causes Goladier to run off, and we hear this commotion with Coronier trying to find out what's going on, and we finally settle down what's going on. Coronier and I go off and try to find Goladier. And we finally do it. Goladier is confronting a great troll, and the troll and Goladier, they kill each other. And Goladier, in his final words, says that he is finally free of Gothmog, of Mordoroth. He's finally free of them, and of course, this breaks what is keeping Mordoroth alive. So therefore, that means we have a chance now of, at some point, killing him.
By the way, to butt in, that troll killing scene is probably the most epic scene in all of Lodro.
Yeah,
I know. Epic.
It's the best thing I've ever seen, ever.
So then, we then head into another thing about now trying to find Mordoroth. And we do this, and we are joined, Coronier and I are joined by Horn and Hauros. And the four of us go together, and we head out and trying to find them. And along the way, of course, we find another raid. And this one, and this guy is real nasty, and he, of course, throws spells on us and stuff like that, trying to keep on to it. And he eventually sends some hoodlums to go and attack Horn. But Hauros steps in the way, and Hauros is the one that takes care of them, and he is the one that is killed instead. And when Hauros is killed, then we go and take care of the wraith, and then we proceed on until we get to Aragorn, who is now confronting Gothmog or Mordoroth or whatever name he's taking these days.
Quick question. Isn't that one part something that changes based on how you've played before?
I'm getting to that.
Okay.
Sorry. Carry on.
Okay. Then Gothmog is the... and Aragorn are then are both talking to each other and training. And of course, Gothmog gives his big threat. Don't worry, as long as that sniveling Goladier is alive, there's no way I can be harmed. At which point, Halbarad starts laughing at Gothmog because of
course... You know, for a guy that has had good judgment all up until this time, not the best...
Not the best plan. That's right. He keeps on laughing at it. And yeah. Says, why are you laughing? Oh, that's because Goladier just died killing a troll. So note, your protection no longer exists. What do you mean? That clown actually came up from the north, down from the north? Ugh. Anyway, in anger, he then kills Halbarad. And at that point, Aragorn shows his anger in there, saying that they will hunt them down and all that stuff. And when he does, he scares off just about all the orcs that are around him. Slowly, one by one, they all start running away until finally Gothmog himself withdraws from the battle, thus ending the Battle of the Pelennor Fields, but with great loss. That's right. Horn survives because of the great sacrifice of Hauros. What do you mean Hauros is in the Shire? No, he didn't come along? Oh, I guess Horn must have gotten killed after all. Or Maven, I presume Horn gets killed in that case, right?
Well, I did. I actually, I think, did the one where you did, because I sent...
Oh, I thought
Horn did not get killed in mine.
Oh, he did not get killed in yours. Okay.
No, but I was with.
Okay. Did anybody have Halros stay in the Shire?
My questing partner, when I did the epic, had not. I mean, so I was like, "Oh, Horn's over there," and he's like, "No, he's not." And I'm like, "Yeah, he is." He's like, "No, he's not." There's like blank space right there. I'm like, "What?" So, yeah, and then you know we got to the end. I'm like, "So Horn's not here?" And he's like, "No." And so then finally, I guess Terry had told me about it, and so I asked him finally, and he's like, "God, I don't remember what I did. Kind of thing." So yeah, so I guess so the difference was there was no ranger to take the shot, and right. Horn died.
Okay, anybody else? We have 30 more seconds before the spoiler window.
Of course you know that, Pine Leaf.
So anybody else?
Really, it's been 20 minutes already?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. See, I always think that you set these windows too short anyway.
Yeah, we should like tell people, hey, if you're just tuning in right now, you should probably skip ahead another 10 minutes because we're going to keep talking about spoiler stuff.
Absolutely. Yep, so continued spoiler alert if you're just tuning in right now for another 10 or more minutes.
All right. Or the rest of the broadcast.
Right now is the 20-minute point exactly. If you have returning, and if you didn't hear what Andang just said because you did it exactly 20 minutes, yes, skip ahead another 10 minutes because we wish to further discuss this epic storyline.
The pine leaves of the world.
Yes.
We're just not worthy of pine leaf, are we?
We're really not. We're so privileged to have pine leaf on the show.
All right, so what do you think about the epic?
It's epic.
It's epic.
It was appropriately epic.
Yeah.
It was draining.
It's draining.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, considering how I have been the guy who has dragged his feet and said, yeah, I'll get to level cap eventually.
Yeah.
today was the first day in all of my 4+ years of playing LOTRO that I was actually playing a character in the current content when it was the current content. So that's like huge for me. So I'm doing all of this and I'm going through, and for the past, I don't know, like 4 or 5 days, I've been streaming my epic binge, and I've been going and I've been doing things and I've been voice acting and I've been just carrying on. And I got to it this morning after having already streamed for like 3 hours, and it just was like, oh my gosh. It's like, wham, wham.
Yeah.
Recovering from this dramatic wham. Oh, and just again and again and again. And there were times that like Maven and Terry were watching it this morning that I was just like, I know I've decided that I'm going to read this, but I'm literally reading through my own emotional blah, and I just like, much like that, the only thing I can liken it to is that scene in whichever one of the movies is, I think it's The Two Towers, where Viggo Mortensen as Aragorn kicks the helmet when he's at that Rohirric bonfire because they think the hobbits have been burnt alive because of this night raid of the Uruks. And you hear him just utter this primal scream as he drops to his knees, and you're like, wow, he's really frustrated. You come to find out during filming when he kicked the helmet, he actually broke his toe. And he turned that into a performance. So that's exactly what I did this morning. I'm like, when I was reading the text about Theoden, I was reading through tears going, ah, it was just, it's so, yeah, when I got done with it, I just had to like go, okay, guys, I'll see you later. And I just turned off my computer and left the room. I was like, I'm done. I'm done.
I mean, when I first played it, Beck, my fiance Becca, she called me. She's like, are you okay? Because like it really, like, it's a good story. It really, you know, really affected me.
Yeah, I had to stop recording as well after I finished this part. It's amazing how well that they captured the emotion of what goes on at Pelennor.
Yeah. I was in the middle of it when I had an LPN call, so I had to stop in the middle.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. Did everybody do the Battle of Pelennor in one sitting? Because I actually waited till I knew I wouldn't be disturbed, and then caught up at the end of that road near where the Woses are and took off there and did the whole thing in one stretch. Because
I did the whole thing in one stretch, starting with the charge, like with that quest.
Yeah, I did as well.
Yeah, see, I tried to stop there.
Somebody said that, no, you got to do this next thing. It's awesome. just so you know. This was at like 1 a.m. after I had already been streaming for like 3.5 hours.
You say,
and so I'm like, oh.
That's when I put it down. I went, this is no good. You know what's going to come with this.
Well, it's like when you look in the chat room and there's like 5 or 6 people and one of them goes, dude, you should stop right here. Because if you don't stop, what's next is amazing. Stop. And I'm like,
I found it so compelling, and it was such a well-written story that each step kept you in and on the edge of your seat, basically carrying on to that next bit and the next bit. And I thought they did Theoden's demise really well, actually. I was you know, worried that it was gonna be less than good, to be honest, or rushed or something, and I thought it was really well done, really well written. And I basically stopped F12. Screenshot. I'm going to relive this because I don't have another level 100 character, so grab some of these moments. Yeah, oh, I love
it. I think I did my first time through. I think I did. I can't remember if I did it in one sitting or not. Let's see, the third time, I think, which I did today, I think I might have done that. It might have taken me 2 sittings. It was either 1 or 2 sittings for that. Of course, my second one, I'm not actually finished with my second one. We haven't started that first because that's the one I'm recording, and I'm, of course, doing that in 20-minute chunks. So, yeah, that's...
Yeah.
That'll take a while.
That's going to take a while.
It does take a while. I can confirm.
I mean, just doing... The way they've aligned the days and the tech that went involved to really making the day feel like it progresses from section to section. I love how they integrated both the epic battlefield and the phasing like they did in Helm's Deep to give you this story throughout this battlefield. The tactical maps are absolutely brilliant. Mm-hmm. The way you do kind of get these... You're in the middle of a battle. There's one point towards the end when Eomer is up on top of the rock looking out at the harbor, and you see the black sails of the Corsairs. And in one... there I go again. In one hand, you can see the despair. Like, oh, it's all over. We're done. But at the other hand, you know... No, this is a good thing.
Yeah.
And I was playing both sides of the coin at that point, and I was just like floored, going, holy crap, we're screwed. We're going to die. We're all going to die. And I'm thinking, no, wait a minute. I read this book. This is not going to be that bad.
Slash tell Eomer it's all okay.
Yeah.
Eomer going to actually ring our necks because we didn't tell him and we knew.
Yeah, there is that little matter.
I loved the way they integrated the Lotro story with the book story. I thought that was really well done.
Now, one of the things that they also decided that it would be inappropriate to have the voiceovers for, because I've done it in Wardens, and if they were doing it as they did some of the early ones, when the predictions came through, I would have heard a voiceover from Galadriel's voice. And they decided it would have broken the moment if it had come in. So they chose not to have the voiceovers, despite the fact it was the fulfillment of the prophecy.
You know, I think that's a really good choice, though.
I do, too.
Galadriel could have been really heavy-handed at that point.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wouldn't have worked very well, I think, if they had.
And then you hear Galadriel come in, tra-la-la-la-lolly, it's now time for...
All right, now we have 2 minutes before the spoiler window closes, so anybody else have anything they wish to add?
The music. Music was excellent.
The music is just fantastic.
Leave it to Lily Kate to point out the music.
it was great.
You're welcome.
I think for me is amazing. Not just the music and the technical aspects of how they did the battle, but the whole epic story takes this MMO that you've been playing however many years, days, months, what have you, and it elevates it into this cinematic interactive experience.
Yes.
Because the whole time I'm doing all these cutscenes, I'm like, holy crap, these are the best camera angles ever. in this game doing this thing when Goladir does his epic axe leap into the chest of that troll, I jumped out of my chair, whooped and hollered.
It was
and
so
I was
funny.
Cackling like that hobbit.
I know.
And my kids come rushing in like, what's going on? Are you okay, Dad? I've got my fists in the air and I'm whooping going, yeah!
Oh, I was just excited. You know? At the lineup with the Rohirrim, there's me on my little podium between two Rohirrim soldiers, and I'm going, now it begins!
One of the strengths of this game has always been its story, and I think this is it's the climax of the story in the book, and it's become the climax of the story in the game, too.
Yeah.
Of every, so far, like, you start off, you're this dumpy little hobbit or whatever doing your thing, and you're just trying to help people out, and you go through your story. And as you get closer and closer to this part of the story, you feel more and more epic, and you feel more and more like your character has got to be in the appendixes somewhere in the books, because you're just helping things out so much, and you're doing all these amazing things. And this update, in terms of the story, really seals that.
Okay, yeah. It's 30 minutes now, so I think this is where we'll end the spoiler section and proceed to the rest. So, Andy?
Yes, Pineleaf, thank you so much for doing that. That is amazing that you did that all from memory. Fantastic job, Pineleaf. I can't believe that you were that good at that.
Okay.
So anyway.
All right then.
Thank you, Pine May. So let's go ahead and go into our actual review now that we have refamiliarized ourselves with what the epic story actually was. And so we're going to try to talk about our favorite moments without actually giving anything away. If you do need to give away a part of the epic story, you can't think of a way to describe it, feel free to give another spoiler alert. They will be short spoiler alerts for those that are listening and have returned back to the show now. And so feel free to do that. So the first question is a very tough question in this update in particular. What is your favorite epic quest or moment in the epic story?
Axe leap.
All right, the legless inspired axe leap. Okay, yes. Very good.
Just saying. I mean, it's epic.
It is, absolutely. All right, anybody else?
The end of book five.
Yeah. I just liked appearing in the lineup.
Oh, yeah. End of book five, yeah.
I'm so glad they put in the reflecting pool, because I've gone back and done it like 3 or 4 times now.
I know. And it's so cool because you get to see, when they do the panorama, you see yourself sitting there with all those views. Like, that is so awesome.
See, I haven't redone them, and I don't know that I actually ever will. I kind of don't want to. Like, I kind of don't want to do that again on this character in a way.
But that's not rereading a book.
No.
Do it on another character.
To me, it's almost like not like seeing a particular scene and having the opportunity to take a picture and choosing not to, almost, in a way. And I've done that before in real life, and maybe I'm just weird about it, but part of me wants to just like have that as a memory and have that be fine rather than actually reliving it.
Yeah, I can
understand that. Mm. I mean, honestly, for me, there was so much involvement, and I did it so fast. Like, I binged
That's,
go ahead, Maven.
Yeah. I was going to just finish your sentence for you, which I'm sure you're probably used to in your household. Which is, there was so much going on that I have to do it again, because there's so much detail. I was so, like, gobsmacked. You know, the first time I went through, I missed so much of it, you know, and so, yeah, I think it's going to probably take me a few times going through to really get the detail of it.
That's a good point.
I'll go through it on my other characters when I get my other characters there.
Right, sure. Right. Yeah.
But I don't know if I want to go through it on my Guardian again.
Yeah, well, again.
I've already taken 3 Pine Leaves through book 5, so.
Basically taking the same character through again, essentially. All right.
Well, I mean, for me, starting in Dol Amroth like I did, just outside of Dol Amroth, it almost felt like I was doing it at the pace that would have been in the books, because it was really only a few days where it all hit the fan and stuff went down. So I felt like it was very frenzied, and it was very like, I haven't the slightest clue what's going on in the rest of the world because I'm focusing on this. I mean, I didn't do any side quests except for like whatever auto-quested while I was killing something else for the epic, and I just boom, 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 go. There's so many moments that are just really lingering in the air, but honestly, the one for me that just kind of has stuck was at the very end, when there's that little green text at the bottom to be continued. All I could do was I planted the banner of the king next to Aragorn. I spun around, I took a screen cap, and then I logged off.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't do anything else at that point. I tweeted the picture out. It is now my desktop on my computer. And that's all I can do right now. Because I'm just like, ah.
Yeah. All right, anybody else before we move on?
There's just so much in the epic that's good that you could pick from. There is. You know, it's recommendable.
I think my very first, like, oh my gosh, moment was in the Warsteads. Especially when, with the meeting between Gondbury Gon and Theoden. I walked into that, I was like, oh my.
Yeah.
And then it just got, you know, and then it just got even more my from there. So that was definitely a favorite moment.
Awesome. Okay, so moving forward from this epic story, Update 18's epic, how are they going to top this? Are they going to move forward?
That's what we asked last update, too.
That's true. That's true.
They have set the bar pretty high, haven't they? Well,
they're gonna have to do something with, you know, Faramir's not dead. There's gonna be some kind of insinuation between him and Eowyn at some point. We're gonna get maybe or maybe not another
book story spoiler alerts, by the way. But continue, Carve.
Yeah, you're gonna see movement of discussion. There's gonna be, okay, so now what are we gonna do? Because Frodo's doing his thing, and there's all this stuff going on. And we may see some little Minas Morgul action going on.
We'll probably end up like scouting.
It's gonna be.
I think it's gonna be a lull. I honestly think that it's not gonna so much be a top as it is we're gearing up for. Holy crap! The Black Gate. You know,
and I think that is absolutely necessary. I think especially where the epic ends off, minor spoiler alert, there's basically no conclusion after the battle, so no, like, wrapping things up in the epic itself, really. I mean, there's a couple of quests, but not really. And so I feel like that they definitely need a lull for the next one. I'm talking more big picture moving forward. How do they get this more? Well, I think part of it is because they actually, major spoiler alert, still have the epic story villain alive.
Well, first of all, I think they're going to have to do, meanwhile, back in Minas Tirith, because we have a lot that happens in Minas Tirith concurrently with what happens on the battlefield that we have not seen yet. You know, we thought we saw it, but we didn't.
It's going to be a ton of errands, Hobbit style.
Oh, yeah. And
they
then
did say that they're going to be building another Minas Tirith, too.
That's right, that's right. And then I think Minas Morgul and Cirith Ungol, I think we're going to have that to do before Mordor, with a raid included to kill Shelob.
Yeah.
Well, is the next
and then the Black Gate, eventually.
Well,
is the next raid supposed to be on the Fields of Pelennor, though?
Well, we know it's 18.2, but we don't know where it is.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, we don't know what 18.2 is yet, and I'm wondering, though, are they going to be continuing the epic story in 18? I know they usually don't do it on point updates, but they have done it once or twice.
Well,
and I'm wondering if it's possible that they might do the Halls of Healing during 18.2.
Maybe
There's more to it than that, though. There's Denethor.
Maybe Denethor's the raid boss.
And there's also the confrontation between Gandalf and the Witch King, which we have not seen yet.
Well, we did see it in a way, didn't we?
We did not. Yeah, but that was a fake.
But what I'm wondering is if they're actually... What I'm wondering is if they're actually ever going to show the real one of that, because we've already seen the fake version. They might just say, you know, what happened to you, Gandalf? You know, what have you been up to?
We've only seen the propaganda version.
We may get a session play, but they're going to have some version of what really happened.
What did they call that? It was a Palantir-induced hallucination.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I don't know if we still need spoiler alerts for... Update
17 by this point.
It's too late for it now, so
that was a spoiler.
Nope. So anyway, I think that there is definitely still plenty of epic stuff, as we just showed. And also, when they do get to the battle at the Black Gate, they already have this new tech to show battles in a very different way already built.
Yeah.
And so they could build even further upon it in the next one. And so I'll be very interested to see how that battle takes place and how they actually are able to show that battle. It'll be very interesting, I think, in the coming year or so.
Well, that'd be interesting, because it almost makes me wonder if there's going to be like some kind of a... timer event where, you know, as you complete objectives on that field, because ultimately we know that battle is essentially a distraction tactic and they're not going to win it unless something else happens in Mordor proper.
Or so, we have another Palantir-induced dream where it does actually matter.
Yeah, so something definitely would be really tricky to balance, like much like some of these other games that have things that are going in the world behind the scenes due to the roll of a dice or the movement of a hobbit or what have you. It'd be interesting to see what goes on if they repeat this battle tech that they're using with the strategic maneuvers per snapshot of the battlefield at the Black Gate, and how that plays out, and
yeah,
who gets to whoop up on what,
and if they have session plays throughout that, even
that would be interesting.
I may not be able to carry the ring, but I can carry you.
Cut back to battle
and kill 10 orcs. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Now kill 10 more. Okay.
Now you kill 4. He's that one that got stuck in the rock, you can ignore him, but kill the other one.
I also wonder if we're going to get to see Frodo and Sam at some point, even if it's in session play.
Well, it'd have to be a session play. There's no logical reason for our characters to be
I wonder if we'll have a session play.
I wonder if Sam will have any more skills.
I think because they did the Dead Marches session play, they almost have to continue the session plays for Frodo and Sam.
I don't think I did that one. Did I?
I want a Kira Thungal session play as one of the goblins.
And then a slow-mo of our death from Sam.
Like the one goblin who gets away.
Oh,
we
that
could
would
do
be
one
cool.
And be Shelob.
Oh, only to have him get eaten by Shelob. That'd be so cool.
Just see the shadow of the spider and then cut to black.
Can you imagine, like you all of a sudden you're running, and then all of a sudden, like in Mirkwood, there's all those webs that take you, and then all you see is the camera go dark as these legs come down.
And your camera's like upside down, and like you're in the air.
That'd be so crazy.
Oh my goodness.
I know
Carr would
never,
love that.
She would never do it. That would be so creepy. I'd be like, "Oh!"
Turbine, we're using our turbine token on that. Make that happen. That would be awesome. Okay, so that's the epic story done. Let's move on to side quests.
All right.
Were there any side quests you didn't like?
Yes.
Meh. Fishing.
No, making fishing. Things laugh.
The so sheep carve? You didn't like the sheep?
I didn't do any of that stuff.
Okay.
Oh, I'm in the middle of doing that right now.
I literally went epic, 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 epic. Even the ones where it was like, kill 10 spiders, I was like, if they're in my way. Otherwise, it's epic, 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 epic.
Okay, minor side quest spoiler alert. I actually started the sheep collection quest where you get these sheep followers that go around with you. So it's funny, Carve, that you did the bad noise and didn't know anything about this. And I actually took them through the end of the Beacon Hills questline, and it made it so much more interesting, because you just hear these baas going on when it's supposed to be this real serious moment, and you're just having to laugh, because it's just totally made fun of by these sheep, and it's so great going around killing orcs with sheep following you around, and like pretending that they're taking hits for you, and things like that.
There was a streamer I was watching that did that, and he called him his army of war sheep.
Oh, yeah. It was so great.
You guys are so bad.
So I guess that was my favorite part. I guess I went a little bit out of order because of Carve's bad there. But in specific, were there any side quests that just stood out as stuff you didn't like, or was it just the fact that there were all these filler quests?
No, the specific one of having to hunt down specific things and using a specific emote at them and really hoping that this better be the one.
Yeah, not having quest strings for that particular quest really sucked.
That one was a pain.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, okay, I'm pretty sure I did that one, but I'll do it again. Nope, I did that one. Okay, where's this one, this last person that I have to do this emote at? So it'll give me quest
that
credit.
That was a pain. Actually, I think there was a certain hunting quest that I found to be even more painful because I completely lost it and I could never finish it because I had a quest arrow from another quest pointing me in a completely different direction. I went that way and completely lost the trail I was on, and I had absolutely no way in the world to get back on it since there was no quest arrow in it, since it was a hunting type quest.
Yeah. In general, I would say that there were more filler quests with this update than there have been in any of the Gondor, Rohan areas.
Well, a lot of it's because the way they make the woes is, when that's not really a spoiler alert, we know they happen, but the way they make the woes is very, like, the quests are Hobbit-like, in a way, in terms of the way they feel and the kind of quests that you have to do. Which makes sense because it's a simple people like the hobbits and et cetera, et cetera. So you're naturally going to have more hobbit-like quests. So going from go kill this and rescue this and kill that and also kill that on the way when you come back, go kill the other thing too. That's what we're used to in Gondor, and we suddenly get go fetch rocks.
Well, and see, Erithert, I actually like those better than the first about 15 quests in the Beacon Hills that are pure, just nothing, no story at all quests, where it's literally feels like we don't have enough content. Here's 15 random quests to barely set up a plot line minorly and just have fun, go do them. And by have fun, we really mean have no fun, because you have to go up and down all these beacons all the time. And it's just, it's really
frustrating. How you really feel.
Yeah, get your speed boosts when you're going up and down there, because you'll appreciate them.
Definitely get your speed boosts. But it's just very, I totally get why they did it, I think, because of the fact that there is so much story crammed in to Pelennor, along with all these instances that they had to do. I totally get why there's less story with this update. It's very annoying that possibly one of the final areas in Gondor that we do will have the least amount of story in the zone itself.
Fair enough.
Well, let's face it, everybody in the area is so preoccupied with the war, what other story is there?
That's true.
It doesn't sound like there would be much to Beacon Hills except rumors of passings.
There is a plot line that, spoiler alert, brings back some riders from Rohan that were a collective group that may or may not have had a cinematic trailer made about them.
Oh,
well,
those guys.
Yeah, there was that little group.
And I actually, moving into what our favorite side quests were, that was probably my favorite side quest series, was that, except for maybe the ceremony that the Wozes did. That was a pretty cool quest, too.
That was a fun little one.
Oh, that's my
I've
favorite
been told that I need
quest.
To have somebody bring a goat to my wedding. Becca did not approve when I told her.
Marriages should have laughing. That's all I say to you there.
Yeah.
A little bit laughing.
Becca didn't approve of the idea. Just saying.
All right, anyone else's favorite quest?
Well, you reminded me that I need to finish that certain quest lines because I don't think I ever, because I think I proceeded with the epic and never got around to finishing.
It's actually absolutely amazing. I don't want to spoil it, but where it ends is fantastic. Okay. I really enjoyed that plot.
Yeah, I have to remember to go back and do it now since I've forgotten about it.
If you did buy the region, I recommend making sure that you do the Rider's Quest that is in the Beacon Hills. I don't remember where it starts. Look it up on Lotro Wiki. It's completely worth doing.
I actually really liked that one hunting quest. Probably the one that Pineleaf lost.
Yeah, because I completely lost it, yeah.
I actually liked that one as well because I didn't lose it, but I can totally see how it would completely ruin it if you lost it.
Yeah, you basically have to cancel it and start it again. Yeah,
or look very closely on Lotro Wiki and hope that there is enough notes there to be able to follow it.
All right. We'll see. I could probably cancel it and start it over again. That might be a good
idea. By the way, did any of you get the Traverser of Entwash Vale deed? I did.
I think I did.
Where you had to run around and find the Cairns and the Entwash?
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, oh, goody. This is fun.
Yeah.
I didn't pay any attention to deeds yet. I was just doing quests.
Well, I was in the middle of doing a daily and ran across this Cairn. And, you know, you see something shiny, you pick it up. A quest.
Exactly.
Something opens up. You know, what can you say?
There's actually quite a few of them.
I've got the Beacons one. There's quite a lot of quest deed, meta deed collection things going on, isn't there, in this region?
There are. I just wish that they had more story.
I'm bummed that the Faranorian Explorer includes the roving, I mean, not the roving, it's the warbands. I was not happy about that.
Oh boy, war. Okay, I don't think we've gotten to that point yet on this, but I was just thinking about the, I think this goes under, was it landscape or something else with...
Oh.
My biggest headache in this entire...
This is kind of a random thing, but one big negative I had with this update, not just in the Woz's area, but in the zone as a whole, there seemed to be way more things that were sticking up in the path of my war steed.
That's a landscape thing. That's a landscape.
Lots of trippy routes.
I was waiting for that section.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and move on to landscape then, since we're already talking about areas
no
of the
more,
zone and everything.
No more bumps, please.
They're
war steed speed bumps. That's all they are.
When you go into the Woz area, there's a branch that sticks out that is actually not a branch that you can pass through. And so it catches my war steed. It caught my war steed like 3 or 4 different times going into this place. And I would think that I'm way ahead, but I'm not. I'm stuck on this branch that's sticking into the path. It's not like it's off to the side. It's actually covering the path. And there's other things like that, not only in that region, but also in the Beacon Hills as well. It's like that they all of a sudden decided to make certain things be not passable through, and so they just catch your war steed, and it's very frustrating.
Yeah.
Well, get off your steed and stop running over all the little Woses.
Also, I have issues with the fact
I agree with you, Lilacate, real quick, but the problem is, in the Beacon Hills, that's
it's a
mounted combat area, and yet...
That is my gripe, is that you go 10 feet in that area, and you're trampled by someone doing... I don't want to do mounted combat. I am tired of mounted combat. And I have to choose between fighting them on foot, which takes half past forever, or mounting up and grabbing half the zone.
And that's absolutely right. The packing was much, much tighter in this one.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't...
I mean, you don't draw just one. I mean, there's at least two every time.
Yeah, I just opted to go on foot and let it take forever.
And if you do it on foot, at least on my champion, who doesn't do much melee, a lot of times they'll just run off in a direction and they'll keep running until they're almost out of aggro radius, and then they'll come all the way back. And it's...
That's super annoying.
Yeah. So I feel like that for whatever reason, they just completely ignored how the mounted combat stuff should have been balanced in the Beacon Hills. It felt very unbalanced. And then also just Warsteeds being stuck on stuff in general was way higher in the zone as well, which was not a good thing. I they've made so much Warsteed content, you'd think they'd know how to do it now. I know that they were preoccupied with other stuff, but that doesn't necessarily excuse it.
Did they actually say whether it was done on purpose so that people might not
I don't think the zone? I don't think very many people have brought it up on the forums, to be honest, so I don't think it's actually been talked about really yet.
So I mean, it could have been done on purpose for the ambiance?
Maybe. I am not sure. I would be very interested to find out if that is the case, but I don't think it is.
If you're going through that forest on your war steed, you're going to trip over every sticking up root and thing and be annoyed, aren't you?
Yeah.
It only took me five seconds till I was cursing.
Well, honestly, I think that's intentional. Even though the trees do have that root problem, when I read this story, I've always read the idea that there's a reason why the Rohirrim were stoked to find this hidden path through the forest, because the forest was obviously an impassable barrier for this army of Rohirrim. So the forest in the game plays like it feels in the book. You wouldn't have these Rohirrim zipping under the trees like they would. You could even do it in Fangorn, or for that matter, the Balewood. You can zip through the trees because the underbrush doesn't impact your movement, but the forest of the Druid, holy crap, Batman.
And I'm a little bit more okay with that. What I have an issue with is, in particular, some of the branches that do stick out. And the problem is that they're very small. They're not like these big branches. They're just like twigs that are sticking out, still attached to the tree. And so when you ride through, your character covers up the branch if you have your camera at the wrong angle. So you don't even know that you're stuck on something. Unless you turn your camera and see that, oh, I'm stuck on a branch. And then you have to stop and go back around. And it's just a frustrating gameplay thing.
I've never had that problem. I just have never had that problem.
I never attempted
to run my war steed through the,
I do all the time,
through the Woses area.
Well, usually in the Shire, I get stuck on every lamppost, so I'm kind of used to it. I just can't.
And I eventually just gave up trying to be on a war steed in this zone.
What you have to think, though, Andag, is that this is a forest for a small dwarf-like...
Right, yeah, I totally get
that. Woses, right? And the Woses would look at you and say, in Tower Druidan, forest don't go through... Wait, let me try this again. Hold on. In Tower Druidan, you don't go through forest. Forest go through you.
You know, it's actually grown on me. No pun intended. The forest has.
I agree.
When I was first in there, I was having a heck of a time, and I seem to, I seem to have improved. I don't know what the heck's happened.
I think so. Yeah. Just knowing, it's kind of like Moria. The more you do it, you eventually either get completely sick of it, or you start to actually learn the paths and start to really admire kind of what has gone on.
Well, see, that's what somebody compared it to Moria up on the surface. And so going into it, I had that mental picture. This is a forested Moria on the surface. Okay, I get it. I'm in 3D land, and I started navigating as such. One of the things that I really liked about the way they laid out Tower Druidan, haven't been to the Beacon Hills yet, but when I was racing through the Rohirric campground, which is ginormous and broken into like 15 different subcamps.
That should be really cool.
I was like, this is so annoying from a questing efficiency perspective. But from a story realism perspective, you've got 10,000 guys on horseback finding wherever they think they can lay a tent in a forest. It's exactly how it should be. And aside from the occasional, dwarf coming through. Sorry, oh, didn't you step on your head there, buddy? As I was running through these campgrounds.
I know.
It was like, this is great. And then I'd get to a point where I'm like, okay, I need to be there, but that's like a 50-foot draw!
From a visual perspective, this zone is fantastic. It's different than any other part of Gondor that we've had. And it's a nice breath of fresh air from a visual point of view, I think. Mm. Not to mention the beacons that are like these awesome things that are sticking out throughout. Not so fun when you do quests on them, but really nice to see just this amazing, amazing chain of beacons and realize how close Gondor and Rohan actually are. It's really cool.
Actually, I'm somewhat curious to see if it's a faster route to take a chicken. I'm sure, remember that? Yeah, I'm sure it may be faster, but I'm sure it will be a lot more dangerous.
Yeah, the.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I think those goblin. I think a goblin rider in the Beacon Hills is going to have a chicken dinner.
Definitely.
Oh yeah, and there's Vareg. The Vareg hang out on the road.
Oh, the Vareg.
On the road, yeah. You're going to have to clean out that whole camp, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it would be interesting to see if it would be faster going that way as opposed to through the Paths of the Dead. But really, I mean, the Paths of the Dead isn't long. It's the going, you know.
It's after that.
Yeah, it's after that. That's the interesting bit. Yeah, so I'm kind of somewhat curious to see if that's a thing. But then again, I'm like, yeah, kind of put in my chicken time for now. I'm still not to the point where like, yeah, chickens.
Yeah, but it's definitely immersive though. I mean, from the closeness of the forest to the open vistas of being up on those beacons, you know, they're both wonderful and they're both so different, but in the same areas being next door to each other, it's really interesting as a player to just go in there. Still very gloomy though.
Well, it's still Dawnless Day.
Yeah, enough with the gloom.
Which, by the way, should the Dawnless Day be covering the Beacon Hills?
I think so.
I think so, because they could see it in Rohan.
Mm.
That's true, they could, couldn't they?
Well, the question is how thick it would be there relative to...
If only that sentence wasn't in the books, we could have a nice, bright time. But I think, the more I thought about it, actually like the idea of the Dawnless Day still being over the Beacon Hills, because from a mood and story standpoint, I think that it actually works really well.
I mean, it's not totally gloomy. I mean, if you get there in the dawn, there's a nice light on the horizon.
The fires of Mordor, yes.
The red. No, I mean, if you go back the other day and you catch it in the dawn, you get the nice dawnscape.
Yeah, you do. And it is more pronounced in this zone than it has been previously. One thing that I was hoping was that they would make the sky be phased so that after you finished Pelennor, you at least had...
Yeah.
It either went away or you had the option to choose whether or not you wanted it to go away or something like that. I know that would probably take a lot of work to make happen that might not be worthwhile, but it would have been nice to be able to go back to all the previous parts of Gondor and that have the Dawnless Day and see them without.
Oh, and I recommend if you're doing that forest to actually play it with the music on, because some of the different themes mixed with the drumming are really great. It's a really good listen. So it's worth it if you don't usually play with your music on to have a listen.
All right. Anything else on landscape?
Can we just talk for a minute about the fact that the Wozes, for whatever reason, don't seem to believe in handrails?
Well, they have the same philosophy as the elves.
And the dwarves.
Then, like, 2 minutes of being in the Woz village. Yep, that was me. I ended up in the water.
So how many of us got stuck in the water then at one point or another? Because I did.
Yeah, but think about how high, like, guardrails for Wozes would be. They really wouldn't help the taller players, I don't think. We'd still go over them.
Yeah, the only thing they'd help would be the
hobbits, probably. Exactly.
What about the Wozes' outfits then, being all bark and lavender and leaves?
I thought that was pretty cool.
Do you think maybe we could start up some kind of trade enterprise to bring him, like, maybe some elven silk togas or something?
That would be a hilarious parody. If some Zinger, get on that. Get on that now.
An advertisement. Get on that, Carvin Earthert.
Oh, that would be awesome. All right, anything else on landscape? Okay, man, this update is huge. There were also instances with this update. We've been talking for already an hour and a half. Well, not so much on the review side of things, but this episode has already been going for an hour and a half, and we have just now gotten to instances, which is another big part of this update. And so my questions for these are not the best questions, I'm going to be honest right off the bat, but for those that have gone through the new instances already, do you like them?
No!
That's just because you get wrecked.
Why not?
Oh my gosh, I have tried and tried and tried and tried and tried to do the Black Serpent in different groups and in different, it just, I haven't succeeded yet. So frustrating.
I can't get past the first boss, and everybody's telling me, "Oh yeah, the other two bosses are tougher." Yeah.
I know.
This is on tier one.
Yeah.
In which
people are soloing it, and it's like, really, really.
Is it the three man or the six man?
Three.
Well,
man.
I did it with three, and I was being.
It's a three man.
The shreds.
Black Serpent is a three man.
Yeah.
And it's just. I haven't been able to do it yet. Now, you know, I'm not talking about the professional people who do, you know, oh, I did it in 2 minutes solo on tier two.
With
I'm talking about, like, regular normal people. And it's just, I mean, it's just, I got so frustrated last night. We couldn't get past that guy with the dog, and it was just like, oh, my God.
So have you done the other instances, Meg?
Yeah. Well, I did.
What are your thoughts on those?
Well, the Harland one that I did with you and Terry didn't seem as difficult, except for the trolls. That trolls one, the trolls part, which is what, the second boss, first boss? Can't remember.
I don't remember.
It's one of those deals like the spider and in their absence, you know, it's like the first boss is the hardest and the ones that came after aren't so bad. And then, you know, I mean, Terry and Pineleaf and you and I tried to do Silent City. Of course, we did it four man, you know. That was... hard.
Yeah, that was back in beta, there. And yeah, that was...
Yeah, that was hard. I mean, that is definitely a six-man, as far as I'm concerned. For me, normal player here. anyway.
Oh, for me, it's...
But, I mean, I think they can be fun. You know, I think I'm looking forward to actually completing it because I have such a sense of satisfaction, you know, doing
and
it.
And I think it's good. It seems to be a good balance of challenging and doable.
I just can't buy the premise of Silent City. The premise just feels so weird to me that, I don't know, I don't think I could get into it.
I just figure it's not even really part of the story. It's just an instance. But, you know, I think the one advantage of it, maybe, for, you know, normal lazy player here, that gets me out of my laziness is I think you really have to plan them. I mean, this Black Serpent needs the standard trio of healer, DPS, and tank. That's what you got to have. And they have to be buffed up. I mean, we had last night, I was running with a 103 and a 101, I think, and Glord was 105, and we were running it. We went down as low as 100 and still weren't able to do it. But the thing was, you know, the guys weren't, they didn't have their, you know, they didn't have their 103s and whatnot outfitted. You know, they didn't have essence gear, and they didn't have the buffs, and they didn't, you know, and so they said, okay, we're going to go do that, and we'll try it again. But, I mean, I think it is good from that standpoint. It requires some planning. You really got to think about it. You can't just go in and just do it. Normal players can't go in and just
But when you're doing the epic storyline, they give you a message saying, this is a good time to do these things, which means...
Yeah,
you should be doing it when you're newly at 105. Doing the epic is when you should be able to do the instances, at least tier one.
In theory, yeah.
Well,
I'm wondering if...
You know, I mean, I did do it with a well set up warden and a healer that both were well set up, and we made it all the way to the last boss. We probably would have, you know, gotten through it, except we just got so tired. It took us a while. But yeah, I guess that's a good point. I mean... You're right. I mean, because it's not even 105, is it? At that point in the epic, you're not even...
No, it's 105. No, book six is at 105.
It is. The whole book, yeah.
Okay.
And
explains a few things.
I think that brings up a good point, but also these are optional instances.
Right.
And I'm thinking that Turbine made these for more raiding-type players, not so much average normal player.
So I can't... I know I did the 2 3-mans on beta.
Probably alone.
Say again?
Probably alone. I'm teasing you.
Yeah. I'm trying to remember. There's K's and then the Silent Street is the 6-man, right?
Yeah.
And then what's the other 3-man?
There's the Blood
of the Serpent. Blood of the Black Serpent. That one, I mean, that one, I got to the first... boss, like when you have like the two guys and the horsemen running around, or riders or whatever, the one that goes back and forth. It was really cool, actually. I think I managed to do that one all the way to the final boss solo. And then the other one I could do to the final boss solo. But I mean, I've done them since then. And I mean, you're right. Like if you've got a good group, they're not. They don't seem to be terribly difficult. I've not done Silent Street yet, so I have no idea on that one. But it seems like they're like you said, they seem like they're balanced a little more to be difficult, not to the level that like that the Osgiliath instances were when they first came out, where it was very, very hard for an average player to do.
You mean they're easier now?
They've gotten a little tiny bit easier. and especially as people gear up past them.
Well, yeah, that's true. You know, now being 105 with the gear and stuff. Yeah, no, I've got my my hunter's out now up to 30,000 morale, so she at least will make it past like the first gate in the Osgiliath instance.
So, here's a question: do we think that, given what we think normal side quests are, and the fact of that they're priced at their normal price, assuming that a player is interested in doing instances and also interested in doing side quests, is this combined price that you have to purchase both of them at the same price, is it worth it given the side quests and the instances that you're given? What do you think?
If you like doing instances, yes. If you don't particularly care to do the instances and one instance is pretty much like doing any other instance, then yeah, it's something that would be a lot harder of a decision. But if you like doing instances, if you've got a kin that you want to do instances and stuff with, these are fun ones to do and good ones to learn some good mechanics on. You can't you have to know your class well, and you have to do really well, and you have to work at them, and you have to work really well as a team to get them done. So it's a good challenging instance. That's a lot of fun. Are the ones that I've done.
All right, and if you are wanting to do just side quests and you're kind of an average player, you kind of enjoy them, do you think that if you don't like the instances, because we already answered the other end of the spectrum, do you think if you don't do instances or anything like that, that it is worth the purchase price of 1995 turbine points?
1995? That's a bit steep.
It's a bit steep.
I would say...
I don't know. That epic battle is probably worth 1995 to me. But, yeah, go ahead.
But you can do the battle.
Yeah, the whole epic story is free.
Well, that's right, it's free. That's right.
Yeah, so this is just side quests.
We're talking about the side quests and the instances.
That you're paying $20 essentially for.
Yeah. Sorry, Lilacake. I talked on top of you.
Oh, no, I was just thinking, actually. I was just trying to decide whether I thought it was worth it or not at that price. It really depends how you get your TP, because I'm not sure if I would pay that much for it.
Yeah.
Maybe half that much I'd pay for the side quests, and I love those side quests, so...
I think if there's more story, particularly in the first part of Beacon Hills, and, you know, if they at some point add in more story, then I think that these would be worth it. There are some good quests that are in there, particularly the Rider's Quest, as I mentioned before. Also, some of the Woes quests are really entertaining, and also the conclusion to Beacon Hills I think is actually really good as well. And also the conclusion to Tar Drudan is really interesting.
I think if you get your TP in a sale and there's double bonus points, maybe.
I agree. I think also, and we're kind of moving on into our general questions, I think also giving these deed requirements being made lower and allowing people to have excess turbine points somewhat makes up for the cost, because that assumes that everyone has a bit more. That doesn't necessarily justify it, because just because they got more turbine points doesn't mean that it's any less an amount in actuality. They could be spending their turbine points on, you know, anything, previous zones, they might not be the appropriate level or things like that. So, I don't know. Do you think that the deed requirements changes your impact on the cost of this update, since it was part of this update?
I'd say no.
I'd agree. I mean, I'd agree.
It's nice. It's needed. Lowering some of the deed requirements is great, because they make them less grindy. And I don't know if we're going to have time to talk about our week in LOTRO or not.
We will.
Okay. So I'll save it for that. But yeah, it's great. in terms, if we're moving on to random stuff, the Guardian, two things that annoyed me. One was the whole, yeah, you know all those 50 essences you just got and the gear that you worked hard to get? Yep, you need new stuff now. Yeah. You know, that's that part to me, and the fact that, yeah, you can get a level 105 essence, but you can't put it in anything until you work and get the 105 gear, and you can't, like, and vice versa. It's just, it seems to be, like, even in the face of, I'd better be like, oh, no more grind. It's like, oh. So my Guardian, I don't really intend to do anything. He's got good enough stats as it is. I'm, for the most part, keeping him with level 100 stuff. Because it's just like, eh, I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
That and Guardian in general, they've made a lot of changes to the Guardian that are, and that we've talked about on the show before, but that are highly disagreeable.
And I'm glad you brought that up, because that is also part of what we're factoring into our final score once we get to that later on.
Yeah,
so.
Indeed. Although, Edgecase, one of the devs, has been interacting with the Guardian forum, the Guardian community there, which is great. It's a start. Like, obviously, everything's not perfect and fixed, and no changes really have been made yet. But the fact that, you know, in his post, we're like, we're willing to admit when we've made a mistake, and then ask the questions and ask for some feedback, and is getting some feedback from people that play Guardians. It's really good to see. It's really, really good to see. So that's something that I'm happy about, that somewhat mitigates some of the changes that were made that are highly not cool.
Yeah. All right, we kind of already talked about this next question, so I'm going to change it a little bit. Where do we think we are going to go immediately next as far as the next piece of landscape that will be introduced to LOTRO?
Tower of the Moon.
Yeah?
You actually get to go on Karandros?
Kirthungal?
Yeah, that would be one, definitely.
No, I know what you're saying.
I think we're going to be back in Minas Tirith, but maybe that's not really the answer to your question.
Right, like, I'm asking what's the next landscape area going to be?
The brown, muddy parts of the Daggerland fields.
Possible as well. All right. Well, let's move on to...
Where's that... I can't think of the name of it. The place where Faramir's rangers are.
That's Ithilien.
That's Ithilien.
I wonder if we're going to get like a North Ithilien.
Yeah, like...
I hope so.
We don't North Ithilien. We've got South Ithilien.
Yeah.
Right, so you think that'd be the North next one. Yeah, that's probably the next
place. That'd be like north of where Kirthungal is. No, Kirthungal's on Upon High. North of Minas Morgul. And then heading up towards the Fields of Daggerlad.
I sort of want to see some Southern Ithilien, Gondor too, because I kind of think
North
Ithilien
is on the map.
Yeah, might be going to the map. We might just be going to some steps.
Up we go!
I think it would be really funny if in the place around Daggerlad there were still orcs that were sifting trying to look for the ring, because Sauron doesn't necessarily buy the whole story by Gollum, so he's covering all his bases by having some orcs dedicated to just sifting for the ring still in the river. I think it would be really funny.
That would be.
Okay, so that does end our general review. We're now moving on to final thoughts. So, first up, were there any secret areas or things that surprised you about Update 18?
There is a ginormous waterfall right off of the Woz's campsite that is really cool.
Yeah.
I saw that...
And it comes like right by one of the Pukulmen, so you have like this sense of scale. It's just
Really
cool.
I had to actually get off my horse so I could get my camera at the right angle and not have horse butt shot.
Mm-hmm.
But I looked up and I just sat there going, "That is so cool."
Yeah.
And what's weird is in this update, that's the small waterfall.
Right. Because there's Rauros,
because there's
actually,
Rauros.
I've not been to Rauros yet.
Rauros is amazing. You literally, if you get close enough, have no way of getting it all in one shot.
Wow.
It is this huge place. It's kind of like Minas Tirith when you're like right at the base of inside Minas Tirith and you can't see the top. If you know, you can't capture everything up there. It's just literally impossible. It's like that, but with a waterfall. It's just amazing.
Cool. I'll have to go back and look at that.
Anything else?
I just love the views from the top of the beacons.
I mean,
it's just like whichever direction you look in, they're great.
Yeah, I attempted to see if I could see Beacon Watch from the end of the line.
One of the most beautiful pictures I've seen, like a LOTRO screenshot, I can't remember who posted it, but I retweeted it. It's somebody, you know, doing the mountain rear up emote on the rock in front of the Falls of Rower,
that was awesome.
Far away. I was like, that is perfect. I don't know how she got her camera so far away.
It's because there's another person that took the shot far away, because there's no way you can zoom out that far. So they actually filmed someone doing
it. It was amazing.
That.
I was like, that's awesome. To me, the highlight of this update and the thing that surprised me the most and will stick with me the longest is the story. The story in this update, it's something that it's something I think Tolkien would be proud of.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, after I played it, I went out and bought a bunch of turbine points just so I had some ways showing my support, because as a lifey, I don't generally have to dip my hand in my pocket, but I thought it was a good way to show my appreciation. So I went and spent some money on the game.
All right. What is your least favorite part about Update 18 as a whole?
Yes.
All right, Guardian stuff for you. Okay.
I think for me it was being squishy again. So I had to start playing a little defensively instead of
What class do you play?
I'm a hunter.
Okay, yeah.
And I probably have subpar gear, but, you know, usually I go through, I say, oh, look, little creature, let's go and take a bit. Ow, my head. Someone just hit me. Stop it.
I definitely noticed when I try, because I did the entire Pelennor Fields part on 5 levels under, and I did notice that it can be very tough when you're facing high-level enemies, even on a champion, to be dealing with that. So
yeah, when I arrived, I definitely had to pay attention. I'm like 103 now, so it's a little easier.
Yeah. All right. Anyone else? Least favorite parts?
I think I already said mine.
Want to remind us finally?
Those mounted enemies in the Beacon Hills.
Yeah. That's pretty rough.
I think my least favorite aspect is everything is far away in the Beacon Hills. I mean, some of those
the way the quests are designed.
You have to drive way to the other end through all of those mobs that finally just talked about. I mean, it's like,
and then there's quests that go back and forth between the other zone too. Although at least then you can take the stable.
Well, hunters are easy because you can get one at Beacon Watch, and then you can set one at the Rahirrim camp, and then you can set something else at the Woz's little milestone. But yeah,
well, that's the thing, you know. I mean, you can do that. Like, I got my hunter guide to the Warsteads and all that stuff. But that
those
part
things
of
are on sale right now.
But that part of the Beacon Hills that's up where the sheep herding is and all that. I mean, there's nothing
a lot
up there.
Of traveling.
There's nothing up there, and it's a long way, even on Warsteed.
A lot of traveling. And isn't that great?
it would be if the ground was flat.
Well, and one
and
thing,
it would be scenic if I could look around and not worry about warbands and, you know, mounted orcs.
Again, one thing that I noticed
is a wanderer class.
Exactly.
That we do, that's true.
One thing I noticed is that the part of the reason why that travel is so hard is because these areas are so underpopulated with people who would actually be having stables that there's only 2 stable masters in the entire 2 regions of this place. And so that's probably the lowest amount of stable masters that we've ever had in LOTRO. And so it does make for these really long journeys. And so, definitely agree with that.
As a player of Hobbit, sorry, Pineleaf, I must think my least favorite part is losing some people that we've known for a long time.
All right, and Terry, thank you for telling me to go and cancel the quest and restart it.
Oh, you're welcome.
Okay.
Did it work?
Yeah, it worked. I've gotten to the particular location.
Hooray! Right.
Awesome. Okay, my least favorite parts are probably the Warsteed stuff and just the fact that they had filler quests. So, all right, what is your favorite part about Update 18 as a whole?
The epic story.
Yeah,
is there anyone who'd say anything else?
The Guardian changes.
Yeah, right. I don't think anyone's gonna say that.
Yeah, no, the epic story.
Yeah, I think we're definitely in unison on that. At least on here. So since we have a little bit of extra time, since we all agreed on that, Talrion in the chat actually mentions that one of the worst things in the update was the rep increase in Minas Tirith, which I didn't even realize happened.
Yeah, it did. And the only way I know to do it
is tier threat.
Has anybody? I mean, the only way to know to do it is to just do the dailies, because I don't think there's anything been added, quest wise.
Yeah, I didn't even notice either.
So is the theory behind that that maybe an orc might take over, and so we better change the rep now to maybe be less accepting of people? That's the only thing I can think of. Anyway, let's see here.
That's probably because Denethor's got more jumpy, isn't he?
Probably. And then they also say that most players claim quest loot is also not good, so that makes sense as well. Okay.
Well, it's never going to be as good as whatever you can get from grinding whatever instances.
Well, the quest loot I'm getting is better than what I had, but what I had was stuff back in Dol Amroth. So.
I mean, it's never as good as the top stuff that you can get, but there's nothing bad about the quest loot.
One thing I was annoyed by is replacing essence gear that's barely better than the previous essence gear.
Yeah.
And well, I mean, you're given the relics that you... For me, anyway, I know that you can get better relics, but I don't care enough to do that. And so I just literally apply the stuff they give me, so they might as well just give me regular gear.
The thing about the essence gear, our characters were so ridiculously good before that you can't give us gear that's really that much better, because otherwise we're just going to get even more powerful and just going to destroy things even more. So it's one of those things where, because of essence gear and how powerful our characters are, you kind of have to do very, very incremental changes to gear at this
point. I would say that they could just make the zone tougher, but then that would mean that some
casual
of these
casual players
and squishier classes. And also, it assumes that all the gear works the same on all characters, which is not true. And so it would be much harder to balance than to just take down the amount of progression that you're getting from the gear, which I think might be the better solution.
I mean, when you think about it, not everybody camped out at level 100 and did the whole epic long stretch from Dol Amroth to Minas Tirith to get grind.
That's true, too.
I didn't. Yeah. I thought I was going to get woefully nerfed going into the zone. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm here running around in gear that has actual stats on it, not slots. And I'm like, I'm going to get wrecked. Oh, wait, this ain't so bad. After doing a little research into Dol Amroth, I said, psh, I'm not going to grind. I'm out. Peace. Kyvet's red, epic riding, you know? So,
but that grind that you're like, nope, is what a lot of players have gone through.
Yeah. You know,
You kind of have to cater to both. People that are new to 105, where you have to give them the option for level 105 gear. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you don't want to tick off the people that are at level 100 and are like, really? You know.
Yeah.
And it's tough, a difficult thing to do. Once you introduce that level of customizability, is that even a word? Customization.
Yes, it is.
Customizability to the gear, you're going to have the min-maxers, and you're going to have the people that don't care to spend the time to min-max. When Essences first came out, I looked at it and I said, that is going to be a gateway for me that I'm not going to cross. And I didn't for a long time, because I know me. I'd be like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do it right. Carve whips out spreadsheets, begins calculating how many pieces of what kind of gear, and how long am I going to have to grind to get this gem to fit in that slot, and how is my guardian? And then I started thinking about the hours and hours and hours, and I started thinking about the wife aggro that would incur, and I was like, nope. So.
All right. Well, I think it is now time to be giving our scores, and so let's go ahead and start with Aerithert. How would you be reviewing Update 18 as a whole? And remember that we're no longer doing plus-minus stuff.
Well, you know what? Then I'm just going to do this. It's because when we think about it, Update 18 is not finished yet. We still have been promised 18.2 with a raid.
That's true.
Which I expect will be thoroughly epic. And hopefully in 18.2, a lot of the issues, specifically with Guardians, but with some other class issues as well, will be fixed in Update 18.2, or at least addressed. Holding out hope for that, I would say B. It, based on story and like the story alone, A. Landscape quest, I've seen better, but still not bad enough to downgrade it from an A. But the Guardian changes, not so much the changes themselves, but the way they were implemented with no beta testing or anything like that, that to me drops it down to a low B, high C, probably a high C. And then if it's addressed in 18.2, then that would bring the Update 18 as a whole for me to a B.
All right. So optimistic and unoptimistic side of things. Very exactly. Cool. Carve, what would you give Update 18 as a whole?
An incomplete.
Yeah, really.
Because I could say that with many of the other people on this podcast, this story blew my mind. The mechanics of the way they did Belnar Fields is top-notch. Mm-hmm. But I don't know about the rest of the zone or the instances or anything else to be able to say, yeah, it was all right. I mean, so I'd have to give it an incomplete. Or, okay. You know, if pressed, because it's an incomplete, if I were to give zeros to all the other incompletes, then it'd probably be like a low C, because there's just too many gaps in the grading chart. But, yeah, so.
All right. Lilicate, how about you?
I've gone for a B, since we're not allowed plus minuses this year. B. I love the story. I love the music. I love the landscape. But I've got a couple of niggles about some of the appearances of some of the characters. Like Eowyn doesn't look like how I imagine her to look. Stupid things like that. So I've fetched it down to a B.
All right, Maven.
Checking to make sure that I'm on. I'm going to go B as well, but I think the reason for the B is the epic story is so epic. I think I agree with everybody here. I mean, I think there's a lot they could be doing that would improve it. So I think B.
All right, Pineleaf.
I can't think of anything other than the epic that grabs me in this update. So therefore, yeah, the rest of the stuff not being there is enough to pull the awesomeness of the epic down to a C.
Wow, all right. Terry.
I'm on board with everybody else. I'm gave it a B also. I mean, the epic was great, no question. A plus plus plus, but, you know, it's not enough to grade the update as a whole with the A. Which all makes right. me sad, actually.
Makes, yeah, me too.
Makes me sad as well.
Well, I mean, for me, like, having just done the epic, and I'm sitting at, like, 102, 103, somewhere there, I'm realizing now that I've got Carvet to this point, I'm like, what do I do to get to 105 at this point? Because I'm like, eh, there's nothing else that I really want to go do except for maybe the instances. But in order to do the instances, I've got to go grind gear to have essences to be able to have decent gear so that I can do the instances and not be dwarf splat. So I'm kind of like...
Epic same exact battles, position. Carve?
I'm actually really glad that you mentioned that, Carve, because I'm actually in a position... That's part of the reason why I didn't like the filler quests, is because the filler quests didn't give enough content to get you to level cap. Like, I would understand adding in the filler quests if it was for the sole purpose of getting you to cap. Like, that at least has somewhat of a more reason to it instead of just being filler quests. But with this update, after doing all the quests that are the side quests and going through the epic story, I actually did not even make it to 103.
Well, I mean, wow. I think it sounds...
I did sword hauls to bridge the gap, which is boring. Yeah.
But doing something like that in order to finish your leveling means that the content was short. And seeing how expensive the content is here, now I don't have to worry about it since I'm a lifer, but I could say that anyone who had to pay for it, that's another reason why I'm pulling it down to a C.
Here's my thing about this, because I think we heard this same deal when we went to Minas Tirith, was there wasn't enough to get you to 100. It only got you to 99. Was that because there's this built-in expectation that you're going to spend level doing dailies?
And I'm actually much more okay with that back when it was in Dol Amroth, I believe, where we were supposed to be going to 100, and we didn't. I was fine with that because there were not filler quests that were there that felt like that it needed to. I felt like the story got in, did what it needed to do, and then got out and moved on. And I was fine with not being at cap and just waiting till the next zone, which I knew there wouldn't be a level increase, and so just waiting till the next zone for that to allow me to get to the next level. In this case, there were many filler quests, and I didn't make it to anywhere near level cap, not even as close as I did before, and so I felt like that there was just this lack of content, but there was already just this filler stuff that was trying to make it seem like more. So really, there was not much side quest content at all when you look at the actual story content. And
from the featured instant stuff and the 105, 100 boxes, things like that, it's pretty clear that you're intended to get to 105 in this update.
Right, and if you do the featured instant stuff and stuff like that, I think I would still be a little bit under, but that would help me get a lot closer. The problem comes when there's someone that just wants to do side quests. And I think I actually am going to do the instances at some point, and I'm interested to see what they're like, because there is some story that's in them, and so I'm interested in going through those, because they're not like the epic battles where there's just no story in the actual epic battles themselves. So I'm interested in going through them, but I still feel like that there's this issue with the experience raise having combined with these side quests where it's just not balanced properly.
I skirmished very irresponsibly to get to cap.
And I'm honestly probably going to be doing something like that. And really, because of the amount of time we haven't had a cap, I think that most players going through the content will probably be 105 before even getting to this area, to be honest. Which, if they do all the quests and things like that, which is great.
I think I'm going to stomp shoes to level cap.
See, I think that's it. I think part of the reason why, I think Talirion in the chat kind of hits it on the head, is that if you were following the natural level progression as a new character who hasn't camped at Dol Amroth for, you know, two updates, you're going to hit Dol Amroth at 99. You're going to do whatever you do in there. You decide to stay in there, whatever. You're going to hit the Ringglow Vale, and you're going to work your way across the formerly level 100 area. So the time you get to Minas Tirith, you're going to be 102, 103, what have you. And so if you're just raising a character naturally beyond this level cap, maybe that was intended that they didn't need to have as much.
Right, and I don't think they did.
Yeah, I mean, really, I know that when I was cruising across, you know, Lebanon and whatnot, I skipped everything, every quest.
And you still got to 102.
And I still, I popped an XP booster, I'm not going to lie. But I knew that I wasn't going to be doing anything except for the epics. But because I did the epics from Dol Amroth all the way through to the Battle of Peldor Fields, there was enough content in there to level me up a little bit, you know, between the VIP and the double XP and whatnots. But I wasn't killing a lot, I was just doing quests. If I had quested that entire thing, there's no doubt in my mind I would have made it to 105.
And I totally agree with that. I think that that's really good, and I completely agree. I feel like that with this update, they could have had probably 30 quests, and it would have actually been just as good, to be honest. Because there were 30 quests plus a couple, you know, filler quests in there that actually had really good story and really advanced things, and it was great. Part of my problem with filler quests in this particular is because the zone is much more expensive, and yet we're getting quests that are not as good if you're just interested in that. So I've already talked that to death. We're going to move on past that.
So
I'm
like
going to
filler quests, you're talking the 10 kill rats kind of stuff?
I'm talking about the quests that are just go kill this stuff, go do this stuff with no story explanation other than I said so. So regardless of what content it is, if it's just go and do this, and I'm fine with auto bestowal quests because I actually like those because you're out doing a story quest already.
They're much more natural. I like them too.
And you're given extra stuff to do, and so I don't count those as filler quests either. I'm only counting ones that are given by NPCs without story reason, and you have to go all the way back out to the quest area just to do this kill stuff and then come all the way back for no purpose. So, now that I've talked that completely to death, I'm going to actually give my score, believe it or not. I know it's been like 10 minutes since the last person did. So, I think that the epic story was fantastic. Best epic story we've had yet. I think it's amazing. Volume 4, I think, is the best epic that we have had so far. I think they have done a fantastic job. It's amazing. Absolutely amazing. I had a very hard time not giving this update a C. If the story was not the best that we've ever had, I would be giving this a C or much lower all day long. There just isn't much else that is interesting to me as a player aside from the epic, and the epic's free. So I think that this update had absolutely amazing things. They brought back instances, and a lot of people actually like the instances if they can actually get through them. And so I think that they did well. I honestly, for a while, when they were going through the epic battle stuff, thought that we would never be getting another large amount of instances that were just instances ever again. And they surprised me on that. They delivered them, and they weren't horrible. They actually were pretty good, except for maybe being too challenging. So, depending on your point of view. So, I think that they did a great job bringing back instances. I actually count them as a pretty big plus. But the rest of the update is just not good enough. And especially when you add in Guardian changes and a lot of other stuff that they did, it's not good. I do like that they added in the extra turbine points that we got, and now that deeds are lower, that's great. Helps get new players not stuck and, lost on the fact that they think that they have to deed and then stop playing the game. I know that ended the game for a lot of people. I'm glad that they're lowering that. I think they could still lower quite a few areas still, and maybe they'll look at that in the future depending on how well they think lowering the deed requirements did here. So, yeah, overall, I would give it a B, because...
You took a breath! Yay!
I know, I took a breath. Overall, I think I would give it a B.
I'm of the same mind you are. I gave it a B for exactly the same reason.
But it's pretty much solely the story. It's writing on the back of that. And it's clear that was the focus, based on the content.
There are some good quality of life, little tiny things that we've forgotten about already.
Yeah.
But that are quite nice.
There were those as well. Yeah, that's a good dimension.
Task boards in the housing area.
Oh yeah.
A couple different things like
relic
that.
Relic and forge really masters cool. In the housing area.
Yeah,
those are big ones. All right. Well, thank you everyone so much for listening through our 2-hour review of Update 18. And Pineleaf, I'm now turning the show back over to you.
And let us head into our week in LOTRO, where we go over what our highlights were during the previous week, and we will begin with Andang, who I hope has a chance to catch his breath in these few seconds.
Don't worry, I'll just die after the podcast, but I'm going to make it through. So I actually finished this week all of the Faranorian zone quests. I had done a few of them before, but most of Tara Drudan, I think probably about half of that I still had, and then I had all the Beacon Hills to get through. And I did all of it, and I did all the Beacon Hills in a single day, along with the Rider quests that go back and forth, but are still considered Beacon Hill quests. And It was a very long day. My throat was super sore after, but I powered through for this review. So there you go. Had a lot of fun doing it. Also, I am still going through the Wildermore epic story. I know I said I was going to beat Pineleaf. That definitely didn't happen. And so I'm still going through there and still pronouncing Glowine as Glowine. And also, I had fun this week on Bingo Boffin. I really enjoyed doing the voices and just, it was great. I really enjoyed going through that story. I know some other people didn't because there was a lot of reading, but when you're having fun with the voices, it's a lot of fun. So, Aerithert, what did you do this last week in LOTRO?
This last week, I kind of have my stuff in my notes backwards, but on Monday, I got my roleplay character. I think his story is going to take him into the North Downs. I did not have the North Downs, so I was like, this needs to be solved. So Carve and I, we did some lightning deeding. We're going to test out how fast these changes makes doing a couple of TP burner characters. And we did. It was fast. We decided, we're like, oh, we're going to do it on Cyrenon just for the fun of it. And it turned out to be a great decision because it was empty. There was nobody else competing for mobs or anything. And I dropped my phone. We just like powered through stuff. It was great. I think it was like 3 hours. We did from character creation through the intro, 3 hours from for all of the Eridluin and the Shire. So it was pretty good.
Yeah, I think it was about 240 ATP, something like that.
Yeah, and then as it turns out, I think the Shire we did entirely everything in half an hour flat.
It was nice.
And today, during the show, I did finish. I did another TV burner character, ran it through the intro mindlessly. It's slower on one character, but I decided, I'm going to go directly to the Shire, pop my little XP doubler in an hour and 14 minutes total from like character creation all the way to the end. It was like 110 turbine points. So it's not bad at all. I like these new changes.
What'd you do in the Shire that gave you 110? Because it's like 85 if you just do the Slayers.
Because I also got a couple class deeds from spamming stuff with the booster.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah.
It worked out pretty great.
Oh, that's right, because you got that 90-minute one.
Yeah.
That's right.
But even if you... Yeah, basically, that's why. So, did that. I did do Samoth Ghoul a couple times with Kinney's. I did it once with Kinney's and once with random people, more for the fun of it than for like grinding. I think I have like 25 coins. Okay. If I happen to get a piece of jewelry and I happen to have the stuff, I might get a piece of essence, whatever, something, but I don't care. My character's good enough as is. And that's pretty much my entire week. A little bit of deeding, a little bit of roleplay. A little bit of tanking. Lily Kate.
Little bit of tanking in my life, sir.
Okay, so start off with some Bingo Boffin. We had two episodes to do this week because the week before I didn't play at all due to family emergency. But some of it wasn't fun because it made Lizzie cry and cry a lot. Bad made of lions. So yeah, I had to resort to the ice cream to cheer up. Ninny Hammers have a new songbook. I finished that yesterday after many weeks' work. And we played a concert. It was yesterday now, so that was fun. It was flawless.
It was yesterday for you.
Yeah, yesterday for me now. Absolutely flawless. My musicians are on point, even when I throw them something a little... bit difficult where everybody kind of has to change instrument apart from maybe two people.
I was one of them, I think.
I only think we had a couple of people that made me had to go, come on, chop, chop. People are waiting. And last Sunday, I explored Eregion for a good-looking holly tree for my Trees of Middle-earth series, which everybody can find on my blog site, theniniap.wordpress.com.
I was wondering why you're looking for a good-looking holly.
Doing a tree every week for each region.
Oh, okay.
For Trees of Middle-earth.
Yeah, the reason
why
I don't
read her blog.
Why not? My blog's nice.
You said, well, do you not read your blog?
If it wasn't for...
No, I was accusing Pineleaf of not reading your blog.
Oh, shame on you, Pineleaf.
I read Trees of Middle-earth. I love Middle-earth.
I didn't even know that the blog existed, so...
Well, you see, otherwise I'd be flooding Lotro Players with all of my stuff and you would be complaining. Because I tend to post something every day.
Okay, should I compare the holly you found to the one in my front yard?
You can try if you want to. Okay, that's all from me.
Only if it's in alliterative verse.
What did you get up to?
Well, I resumed Epic Volume 4 on Kirkhollow Terry during my stream on Sunday. She's finished up the Blackroot Vale and headed into Lamadon, so she's doing Volume 4 and also the Western Gondor side quests, which is a lot of fun. Got to make fun of the guy with his son and his bucket of nails.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I left it a strange place in the storyline because... it got very hot last weekend, and I didn't have my air conditioner in the window yet, so I ended up begging off early because I was sweating to death. But so hopefully longer stream this week. Joined Mythgard on Tuesday for Tuesday fun, and so we did the In Their Absence instances. We did North Cotton Farm, and Sarissa got, my burglar, got into a group with a hunter and a guardian, so we didn't have a healer. So I said, okay, I'll go yellow line and I can sort of heal. And ended up having a last burglar standing moment versus the spider boss in yellow line. Kiting the thing around and throwing, you know, self-healing because the guardian went splat, like, right away.
What?
And the hunt, yeah. He didn't last more than...
Probably standing in the poison.
Yeah. More than, I think it was 30 seconds or so, he was gone. And the hunter, I noticed too late they were standing in the poison. And so the hunter died. And so I'm running around and I'm stunning like Rathil and I'm healing myself and I'm throwing this out. I got her down to 10k morale and then she just ate me. But it was pretty epic.
That was awesome.
And
were your fellowship mates being like, go, 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 go.
Yeah, it's funny because Corey streamed it from his perspective, so you can see his guardian going through it, and he had a similar thing because he was last guardian standing because his party all died. And in the background of him streaming, you can hear everybody else in Mythgard the couple folks in my fellowship going, this is really awesome, Sarissa, you can do it, you can do it. And I'm so stressed out. And then the other highlight this week is I ran some epic battles with Carve while he was on his epic binge, and we actually did a lot better at those than I expected we would. We got a couple platinums on the encounters, which was
awesome.
Nice.
Yeah, racked up some more promotion points. I'm at 178 promotion points on Terry.
That's great.
So, speaking of Carve, what'd you do?
Epic binge. I binged the epic story. As if it hasn't been clearly labeled already. I do not have a lot of promotion points on my guardian for epic battles because I've done them pretty rarely. So I was glad to have some company for those parts of it. It was really nice because when I got to the Battle of Pelennor Fields, Pelar Gear. When I got to that port, I'd forgotten that I'd already done it before on Carvet. So it was like, oh, you're going to do it. Oh, you did it. Good. And so I just zipped right on past. I was like, oh, cool. That was nice. I was the guardian, or rather, I was the hunter that was helping Wigand when he was slowly soloing the first spider boss in North Cotton Farms. And I was standing outside because that spider has an annoying habit of throwing down a poison dot and then immediately rooting you in it. And so if you don't move out of that poison dot, she's like, and watches you die. And so that's basically what happened. The Runekeeper went down first, the Hunter went down second, and then Wigand and Blue Line slowly chipped away at it for the next 45 minutes. And every now and again, the Runekeeper would die because the spider would shoot the Runekeeper through the webbing, and then the Runekeeper would toss a heal on Wigand and then die, and then I would just sit there kind of wandering around watching everything. It was interesting. I also ran the Great Barrows this morning.
Did he win?
Oh, yeah, he beat it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he was getting heals every so often because apparently the Runekeeper was able to channel a heal through the webbing. Because I figure, shoot, if the spider could shoot us, we can heal the Guardian. But, yeah, he did it. It just took a really long time. I think towards the end, I was like, Wigand did it like this, Wigand did it like that. He hit that spider with a wiffle ball bat, so...
But when that's it came pretty right much down, what happened.
That was kind of how it went. But when it came right down to it, he won, and that was really cool. And then the rest of it was easy. We ran the Great Barrows this morning with a friend of mine, his first time running any dungeons in Lotro, and we had a lot of fun. So that was kind of it. And Maven, what did you do this week?
First, I got to make sure my mic is on. Okay. Ran the Rift with three other girls on Sunday in Girls of Middle Earth. So we had Terry and who was it? Feedweek? Did we have Feedweek?
We had Feedweek and we had Riddleberry.
And Riddleberry, yeah. And I had a last hunter standing moment in the Giants room where all the lava is with mediocre help from the peanut gallery. Whoa! Terry's like, oh, she's almost got the giant down. And somebody's, the boss down. Yeah, but she's almost dead. I'm like, dudes, stop it. But I took him down. And then we finally killed the Balrog. Finally got the Balrog killed. I'm so happy that that's complete. Watch Carve run the final book of the epic. We've talked about that. It was so worth getting up early to watch. It was awesome. I love, you know, like you guys are all this way. I mean, we're into the books, you know. So to watch Carve, who knows the books, see the, you know, thing unfold as the books. I mean, it was almost like going through it again for me. So it was great.
I mean, yeah,
definitely
I
a highlight. Oh my gosh. I got Kindred Standing with Riders of Rohan, got the Hunter Guide to Warsteads, yay! And I've started saving up for my very own Rider of Rohan pet. I can't wait. So, Pine Leaf, how about you?
All right, on my Arkenstone Warden, I reached level 105, and I completed the current epic story on that character. So that was the, when I said I had three wardens on the matter, that was the one that I labeled as the third one. And I've also completed the Battle of Helm's Deep for my Bjorning series, which meant going through several epic battles.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah. That was, I think the worst of them, though, were the previous week, because this, I don't mind the Hornburg as much as I mind some of the others. Oh, but they also had the Glittering Caves, which is... I don't like the Glittering Caves. And then on... I finally, after all this time, after making several attempts, have managed to complete Breaching the Necromancer's Gate, the full Fellowship version solo. And I'd made a few attempts at that before. I've always had to abort because I had I ran into a venomous blood arrow that I could not get around. In this case, though, I did run into a venomous blood arrow right at the end, but it was one that I could stealth around, so therefore I was able to get by it and get to the boss and do the boss fight. I can't stand venomous blood arrows when I'm in full fellowship mode because they just rip you apart. And that is it. Therefore, let's head into news beyond Middle Earth. Middle Earth video highlights. The dragon is withered.
News Beyond Lotro, it's still part of Middle-earth, but I know it's late, Pine Leaf, so no worries. So, this is actually another one of those Tolkien poems that have been brought to life, and it's super awesome. Great job, Adele, again, for doing another one. It's fantastic, and I think that her voice really fits this one maybe even more because it's a Rivendell-related one, and her voice just sounds almost like an elvish type song. So I think that this was just absolutely amazing. Fantastic job. So if you're interested, be sure to check it out.
All right. Then let's head into donations. We currently have 25 supporters on Patreon, and if you'd like to join this illustrious raid of players to help support Lojo players, simply go to the donations page where you can support the Players Alliance on Patreon. There you'll find rewards, including a mention on the podcast of your choice, or even be a guest host with us here on Lojo Players News. As for feedback, we have a featured comment from Kaylee Starshine and Terry. What does she have to say?
So Kaylee left a comment on Lojo Players News episode 151. I am a bit uneasy about posting this, as I do not want anyone to misinterpret what I write here as making light of the Guardian's plight or the frustrations of its players in any way. But I think a juxtaposition may help reveal how badly burglars are in need of help. Whereas Guardians are one of the many classes that can solo group content, burglars are often excluded from such content with extreme prejudice. The very few who play burglars at endgame now, and wish to equip them usually go through the instances and raids with other classes and then switch to their burglar to bring them into the instance before the chests are open to have a chance for their loot.
True.
Whereas Guardians now have one trait line that is subpar, all three of the burglar lines are absolutely anemic. And since all three do virtually the same things, burglars are the least able of all the classes to adapt to their circumstance, an odd reality for a rogue class, which would normally have the opposite reputation. Whereas Guardians save their fellowships time and time again, success in group endeavors comes in spite of a burglar's presence, and failure often because of it. Not necessarily because of poor play, mind you, but simply due to the hard limits that shackle the class and the absolute metamorphosis of the game as a whole, in which a class like the Burglar would never be developed in its current state. Legions upon legions of players have abandoned the Burglar, as has Turbine, it would seem. I am hopeful regarding Edgecase's stated wish to give us some attention, but the last developer that spoke such things suddenly disappeared not long after. Please do not make Edgecase disappear, Turbine. He/she seems very nice.
Well, you jinxed it now.
I know.
Very true. I mean, she's absolutely right. Like, the class most in need of love, burglar. Class most in need of nerf bat, warden. I would get ready. Take a quote. Write it down. I would actually almost prefer that burglars get some attention than the Guardian breaking stuff gets fixed. With the exception, honestly, of course, of the radiate bug. That's just absurd with, like, 25 damage. Fix that, please, yes. But I would rather, I mean, for a tenth of the classes, well, there's 10 classes, ridiculous, but burglars right now, yeah, it's bad. I mean, I've played it. I'm a decent player. My burglar's only at 11, and I've died like 3 times. That says absolutely nothing about burglar as a class, but like it's a difficult class to play already. It's a difficult class to play well already, and to have it be in the state where it's in, where it's so, like, it doesn't come in on the best of anything lists, which is kind of a bummer.
I don't understand why she says all of the... Because I thought the yellow line was... because I use yellow line, and I don't see what the problem is with yellow line.
I think...
Now, it's not useful. It is not useful in group content, probably, because I don't think there's much CC in group content.
Not useful in solo either, really.
Because that's what I use it in.
It depends on what you're trying to do.
Yeah, I guess that makes sense.
Every
other class has something that it's good at. A Guardian is good at tanking. That's the Guardian. Guardian is the best tank in the game. A Warden is excellent for DPS, probably the top DPS in the game. Same thing with Runekeepers. Runekeepers are top DPS and top heals. Minstrels, very good DPS, very good heals. Hunters, very good damage if they're built correctly. They're they're not top, but they can do very good damage, especially in redline. Burglars is like, we can make things stop running toward us for a little bit. That's nice.
It is useful when you're doing a skirmish and there are five mobs and you need to slow them down so you can have a chance to kill the others before they
yeah.
eat you to a pulp. But as I said, not useful standpoint. In groups, not useful in group content, but I find them useful in soloing skirmishes.
To my knowledge and from what I've seen of them, a lore master's CC seems to be a little superior to a burglar's.
I think little might be slight. Understatement, but yeah.
Okay. Even still, best CC class, lore master. There's the burglar is like really good at. Where you're like, man, I wish I had a burglar right now. You never really say that.
Yeah, you know.
Well, their claim to fame got nerfed back around level 75.
Yep, it was Isengard days
when it stopped scaling.
Yeah. Okay. Got a point there.
And part of that has to do with the whole fellowship maneuver thing no longer being effective.
For sure.
All right, then, let's head on to emails. First email is from Trotter. And anyone
here? Spoiler warning again.
Spoiler warning for 5 to 7 minutes.
All right.
Less than that, like 5 minutes.
All right, and who wishes to read this? All right, and you volunteered.
Oh, thank you, Pineleaf, for noticing that my hand was up. So Trotter says, I can now give you my thoughts without spoiling anything for you, and if you listen to the review, that's true, because we already spoiled stuff for you, but I am giving a spoiler alert in case you did not listen to the review, so that is there now. The epic in Update 18 is probably the best that they could have ever done, and is my favorite to date, but could have been better. As an example, Volume 4, Book 5, Chapter 8, The Ride of the Rohirrim, is one of the best parts of Peter Jackson's films, with Bernard Hill wonderful narration. And I don't understand why Turbine did not narrate this instance. The real problem for me, though, is Volume 4, Book 6, Chapter 9, The City Stands. I cannot think of a scenario where Turbine has changed what is in the books to suit their story. Horn is, spoiler alert by the way, Horn is buried in Mounds of Mundberg, outside of Edoras in the book. Turbine decided that Hauros would be buried there instead of Horn, but as Horn. I know the Rangers are pretty useless in the game, but I am sure that Aragorn would be very uncomfortable with this happening and would have stopped it. As you are aware by now, Horn dying depends on Hauros, and I have no idea why these two characters have been linked. If you choose in Volume 3, Book 1, Hauros should stay, then Horn possibly does die. Can't confirm this, as I can't remember which of my tunes I selected Hauros should stay. And we'll probably find out from Pineleaf's playthrough on his Beorning, as fortunately I suggested that he pick Hauros should stay.
Oh, he's the one who made the suggestion.
Apparently, Pineleaf. This was unnecessary and should not have taken place. Horn dies at Pelennor Fields. Finally, as a premium player was not happy at the very high cost of Update 18, and the smaller number of quests that you got which were not part of the epic.
Maybe I wasn't paying attention because I was still shell-shocked from what happened in this story. I don't remember them saying they were going to actually bury Hauros as Horn.
They did not.
They did not say anything of that sort.
It was never mentioned.
Does Tolkien ever say where Horn is buried?
No. Not to my knowledge. I mean, I know he's mentioned in that poem of the people that died.
Yeah, so as far as I know, that's the only place where he's mentioned.
I mean, I can pull out the book.
You have it sitting right there.
Yeah, it is sitting right here, basically.
I know it's sitting right here.
Okay.
Grey Haven, Sky of the Shire, Land of Shadow, Tarth, Kirith Ungol, Black Gate opens Houses of Healing.
Spoiler alert.
All right, bye.
The book's
I'll see
been
if
out.
I can find it 80 plus years.
Oh, no, while you look for that, maybe some should read.
Except Pineleaf, there's a request.
That's going to be an issue. Where does
well, actually, I want to respond to some
yeah,
of this
ahead.
Because cause there's actually been a lot of discussion on the forums about
there has.
What happens between Horn and Hauros. And we have a response from Maid of Lions. It's a very short response of Maid of Lions. And in fact, it quotes another player's post. The other player had speculated that what we actually took to be canon for Horn's fate came from a poem that everybody's assuming that Gleowyn has written, when in fact it's entirely possible that Gleowyn didn't actually write that poem, because Gleowyn's the guy with the inside knowledge of what happens to Horn. And Maid of Lions actually posted a response that, in fact, Gleowyn is not the author of that poem.
Is it Pineleaf?
Apparently, in the Middle Earth, according to Turbine, that poem was actually written well after the events have faded into like myth and legend and history.
Which
and
makes
so
sense.
Somebody
because
working
most
from
Gleowyn's things...
notes is going to say that Horn died on the Pelennor Fields.
And that yeah, absolutely makes actually, sense because most things historically were actually written after the fact, significantly after the fact. Right. And also true in Middle-earth. Most things were actually written after the fact. So it makes sense that that would be the case.
I actually found it. The Mounds of Munverg, it seems, actually are not outside of Edoras. But it,
right.
According
Munverg
to this poem... go ahead.
Yeah, Munverg is Minas Tirith. That's the...
Yeah, it says... Well, it says, long now they sleep under grass in Gondor by the great river. So it's been a while, you know, when this poem was written. So it is written long after the actual occasion happens. But it does say, in the mounds of Munberg, under mold they lie. So he's listed there. Horn and Fastrid fought and fell there in a far country. But, I mean, it just says that it's under the mounds of Munberg. In Gondor by the Great River.
Yeah, but it was the poet who said that, and that's not...
Right. And,
so,
this is saying, long now they sleep under grass, so it has been a long while.
So did you say that it doesn't necessarily say that they were actually killed at Pelennor?
It says fought and fell there in a far country.
Fell there, meaning Pelennor?
Yeah, in a far country.
Okay.
So, like, if you're like, oh, maybe he tripped on a banana peel and fell, like...
Yeah,
you
trips
over
one of those roots.
Or Denith.
Yeah.
Or maybe we get a cut at the start of the next book of Denethor just like dangling Horn over the top of Minas Tirith and just ready to drop him.
I don't think the words Denethor and dangling really go together. Oh.
Denethor does the chicken leap and squishes him.
All right, let's go to Eridathalion's letter, and let's see. Lily, could you read this?
Arathurt.
It says, could Arathurt read this in Kermit's voice?
I can't do Kermit, sorry.
Okay, it's the... All right, because I didn't read it because I didn't want any spoilers there, so okay. Arathurt.
Hi, ho there, Lotro Players News. Wanted to send y'all an email. Y'all? I don't feel like Kermit and y'all. Anyway, wanted to send y'all an email and tell you that y'all are doing great. Had a question for you all. What is the primary set of virtues you use? I'm looking for a set that is good for mixed solo/group play. Thanks for such a great, maybe even legendary show. I've been listening to the podcast from the start. From Pineleaf the Skirmish Master to Andang and Tom Bombadil. Yes, Andang, you can do the Hey Do Merry Do.
Hey do, merry do!
And all the hosts in between. Great show. Keep up the good work. Eridathalion, level 27, Warden Arkenstone. Also, had an idea for a sponsor. Try Sauron's Bildenor. Take that and run where you will with it.
Hi, everyone!
Hey! How's it going?
What?
Who are you?
What are you doing?
We're doing a podcast, Lizzie. What are you doing?
Lizzie, what are you doing?
I'm not much. I just woke up and it's 4 a.m.
Alright, go on.
Right. So, virtues.
If... Okay.
Well, he actually did ask a question.
Okay, yeah.
Virtues.
It depends. It really does depend. What I tend to do for my characters is kind of just generally slot tactical mitigation and morale, and then swap things out as needed. On my guardian, I'll have usually two or three that I always have. I can't remember the names off the top of my head, but related to tactical mitigation. And then if I'm doing something like Ruined City where, I need to resist a bleed, I'll swap out a few to get more resistance. But in all honesty, at level 27, just slot the highest virtue that you've got that relates to your class. Tactical mitigation, physical mitigation, both of those are good until you max one or the other out. Anything like morale, zeal is always good. Zeal, fidelity. The one, if it relates to morale, it's a safe bet. If it relates to mitigation, it's a safe bet usually.
I actually typically use virtues to do the opposite thing of what my character is good at. And what I mean by that is, if I'm playing a DPS heavy character, I'll go for more morale just to give myself a little bit more survivability. If I'm going for a tanking character, I will actually go for more damage type stuff. And obviously it depends on if I'm how much group stuff I'm doing and stuff like that, where I will change things out a bit depending on the situation. But typically I like to make a stronger character by getting a different type of stat on virtues, because they're, depending on how far you go with them, they might not make the most difference, but they do make you just a little bit more, you know, have a little bit more meat on your bones if you're damaged, or have a little bit more damage if you already have plenty of tanking and ability.
As a warden, one that you should probably almost always keep on is discipline, because it gives you might, which is going to help with avoidances and damage both.
Absolutely. All right, Pinely, wake up. Come on.
All right. I didn't know if you were already done. If you'd like to email us, you can send it to podcast@lotroplayers.com. You could also follow us on Twitter, The Players Alliance, @PlayersAlly, LotroPlayers, @LotroPlayers, Ending at PVMP _ Ending, Aerithert @Aerithert, Carvet @CarvetLP, Maven @TolkienMaven, Pineleaf @PineleafNeedles, Terry Adwin @TerryAdwin, LilyKate @LilyKateBuggins, and The Players Alliance has 4 live shows every Monday at 8:30 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time. We have DDO Players News. On the last Friday of each month at 8:30 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time, we have LOTRO Academy After School. Every Saturday at 8:30 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time, we have LOTRO Players News, and every other Saturday after LOTRO Players News, we have Tales of the Free Folk. You join us for our live shows at lotroplayers.com/live. Thank you, everyone, for listening. This is Piney Needles reminding you to skirmish responsibly.